Welcome to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight, your host on this Thursday, July 21st, 2016. Alex Jones is going to be hosting from the Republican convention in Cleveland. It was quite an event last night with Ted Cruz showing his true colors. Let me read you some of what people were saying. Boehner says about Cruz, Lucifer is back. Haley Barbour says, I sort of think it'll backfire on him. That's one of the more mild comments about what he did last night. New York delegation rages at Ted Cruz. Roger Stone says, he is one dumb SOB. A Trump ally says he is a self-absorbed little man. Let me tell you what, nobody liked what he had to say last night, except for Hillary Clinton. Because what Ted Cruz essentially said last night was, I'm with her. He not only didn't dance around the endorsement, but he essentially called for people to not vote for Donald Trump. He did exactly the opposite of what Mitch McConnell did. When Mitch McConnell spoke, the speech began with boos from the floor because people are not happy with what Mitch McConnell has done as leader of the Senate. He's betrayed them on Obamacare, on the open borders, and so forth and so on. But what he wisely did was he made a case for electing Donald Trump. So Mitch McConnell started out with everybody booing him. But when he ended up, everybody was cheering him. So you have Ted Cruz come on last night. He had a lot of Cruz supporters there. I think it was very wise for Donald Trump to allow him to speak rather than to play the kind of games that Mitt Romney did 4 years ago, having the Rules Committee rewrite the rules to make sure that Ron Paul was not going to be allowed to speak. I think it was very wise for Donald Trump to give him enough rope to hang himself, to show everybody what he is really about. And that's essentially what we saw last night. He came out to massive applause. At the beginning, when he walked on stage, there was a lot of Cruz delegates there. He had a full minute of applause. And then he walked off with boos. If they'd had any fruit, they would have been throwing it at him. He had to escort his wife off the stage. There was a person in one of the donor rooms that had to be restrained who wanted to physically attack him. He was not allowed into the donor room of the Adelsons. And this is a guy who had courted the Israeli lobby very heavily. One of the things I remembered about Ted Cruz, and of course, you know, in 4 years, he's looking to the future. He's fundraising off of this morning. He put out a fundraising letter talking about how great he was, how independent he was, and so forth. Look, in 4 years, he'll still be ineligible to run for president. He'll still be a naturalized citizen, not a natural born citizen. And he'll still be a lying, dumb SOB, as Roger Stone put it. He told everybody that one of his key issues was the Constitution, yet he doesn't care about the eligibility issues of the Constitution, and he doesn't care about the Supreme Court. If you go to his website and look at what he had to say about the Constitution, it was all about Supreme Court justices. Well, we have to understand that the next president is going to appoint between one and four Supreme Court justices based on their ages. We got three people who are older than Scalia. We've got a lot of people that are really getting old that will not really be able to avoid retirement, perhaps, and wait out another 4 years, certainly not another 8 years. Who's going to appoint those judges? Is it going to be Hillary or is it going to be Trump? It's not going to be Jill Stein. It's not going to be Gary Johnson, okay? If you're not voting for, if you're a Republican and he's telling you, well, Republicans, you don't necessarily have to vote for Donald Trump. Those Republicans are either going to waste their vote and they're going to help Hillary Clinton by voting for Gary Johnson because Gary Johnson's not going to win. Gary Johnson is in this so that he can get federal matching funds. He's just in it for the money. That's the strategy. We always rejected that strategy when I was in the Libertarian Party, but he threw out the principles of the Second Amendment. He threw out the principles of private property, religious liberty, and he did it so he could get money. So if you're voting for your conscience and not voting for Donald Trump, you're really voting for Hillary Clinton. And she echoed that. She put out a tweet saying, vote your conscience. When we come back, we're going to play you some of the clips, some of the reactions of people from last night. Stay with us. Alex Jones will be joining us from Cleveland. Today is the final day of the Republican convention in Cleveland. Alex Jones and crew are there. Alex Jones will be joining us on the show. Actually, he'll be hosting the rest of the show coming on in just a few minutes. And last night we had an amazing display of what one Trump ally called an exhibition of Ted Cruz being his self-absorbed little self here. He said, America now knows that Ted Cruz, what Washington has known about Ted Cruz for several years, that he is self-absorbed, narcissistic. It's all about Ted Cruz. That's the reason Cruz has no friends in the Senate, said Chris Collins, a Republican from New York. He said, so I think he's ended his political career, but in doing so, he disappointed his own political supporters, who may not be enthusiastic about Mr. Trump, but were all about unity of the party and defeating Hillary. Why? Because, you know, if they understand principle, if they understand what Ted Cruz campaigned on, you go to his site, one of the first things he's talking about is Constitution, Constitution. Now, that doesn't apply to him. When he doesn't like the requirements for being a natural-born citizen, when he's just a naturalized citizen, he ignores that part of the Constitution. He doesn't talk about the unconstitutional war on drugs. And you know what? If you ignore things like that, if you treat the Constitution as a living document when it comes to the war on drugs, then the Constitution is going to be a living document when it comes to the definition of marriage. It's just that simple, Ted. Just that simple, conservatives. They're going to be able to do whatever they want, ignoring the First Amendment, the Second Amendment, the Fourth, Fifth, Sixth Amendment. They don't care. They can take your property on the street just by not even accusing you of being guilty of anything in the war on drugs, but perhaps your property was somehow associated with something. When you allow that type of thing to happen, then they're going to come in, they're going to enforce Obamacare mandates on you. They're going to tell you that they can define marriage. And of course, he was right in the sense that a lot of this stuff is coming out of the Supreme Court. That's how they enable it. Who is going to be appointing the next 1 to 4 justices in the next 4 years? The issue is it's either going to be Donald Trump and the Republicans, or it's going to be Hillary Clinton and the Democrats. Do you want to have another 4 Ruth Bader Ginsburgs on the Supreme Court? See, that's what Ted Cruz is willing to do for his own personal ambition. He sent out a fundraising letter today, and he was telling people, I have a vision for the future, 2020. No, he's been staring at himself in the mirror for so long that he is cross-eyed from the self-adoration. He is so nearsighted, he doesn't see what he's going to do to this country in 4 years, and he doesn't see that he doesn't have, and nobody else will have, a chance at Hillary Clinton after she's been president for 4 years. She's going to consolidate so much corruption in the government and the media, you're not going to get her out in 4 years. Absolutely delusional. Other people, John Boehner said, Lucifer is back. Haley Barbour says, I think it'll backfire on him. And he was booed off the stage. So I want to play for you what happened last night. Let's roll this first clip of Ted Cruz.
Stand and speak and vote your conscience. Vote for candidates up and down the ticket who you trust to defend our freedom and to be faithful to the Constitution.
Now, that's when people first realized that he was telling people to vote for her. Vote for her. Don't vote for Donald Trump. Vote your conscience. Well, you don't have that many choices anymore. You know, at one point in time, you had 17 choices. Now you've got 2. You really do. And so that was the point they realized that he was telling people he was with Hillary. That was when they started booing him. And then it got worse. Let's play this next clip.
The party, we will unite the country by standing together for shared values, by standing for liberty. God bless each and every one of you.
So they had to escort him and his wife. They had to take them off of the floor to protect them from the crowd. Absolutely amazing. And then he goes to the donor rooms. And one of the donors wanted to attack him. One of the other donors, Sheldon Adelson's donor room. And remember, he was kind of the co-winner of the Sheldon Adelson sweepstakes for money. Along with Marco Rubio, Adelson was saying, well, I kind of like one and my wife likes the other. We haven't really made up our mind yet. They would not even let him in the room. Not even let him in the room. And this is what they had to say in the New York Times. It said, senior Adelson aide, Andy Abowd, confirmed to CNN that his boss had invited Cruz to visit him and his wife, Miriam, but turned him away at the door after he stunned the audience at the arena by urging voters to vote their conscience in November. When he didn't endorse, he said they were stunned and disappointed. We could not allow Ted Cruz to use the Adelsons as a prop against Donald Trump. Now, think about that. You know, I remember when this all kicked off, and I remember Ted Cruz using some Middle Eastern Christians as a prop. Do you remember that meeting? I was on vacation at the time, and I was absolutely stunned at what he did. He went to a meeting of Middle Eastern Christians who are Arabs. They were being persecuted in their country by Muslims. He was there to talk to them. And instead, what he did was he deliberately provoked a couple of people by saying some things about Israel, and somebody said something about it. And then he really doubled down and started accusing them of being anti-Semitic. And then the boos really started. And he just basked in that, okay? Just like he did last night. Just, he was like, look at this. They hate me because I'm defending Israel. No, they hate you because you use them as props to suck up to Israel supporters, okay? To get the money from people like Sheldon Adelson. And I think even the Adelsons have seen through this. Now, he tried to use them as props against Donald Trump. Truly amazing to me. And you know, it's just the opposite of what you saw with Mitch McConnell, who came on. People were booing him, as I pointed out in the first segment of the show. When Mitch McConnell came on, they booed him because they don't like the policies that he's been pursuing. And yet what he did was he made a case for Donald Trump. He made a case for Republican unity, why you need to have a Republican president appointing the Supreme Court justices, as Ted Cruz said. So he finished up his speech with applause, and it went exactly the opposite for Ted Cruz. Now, joining us now is Alex Jones, who is in Cleveland. He was at the convention last night, and he's going to be there tonight for the final events. Alex.
Thank you, David. Feel free to ride shotgun with me off and on throughout the broadcast. Just want to say the entire crew here on site, but also in Austin, and, of course, the listeners who are the backbone of the whole operation. We've really had some devastating victories here. Hillary for president is now an international meme. In fact, it's one of the few things actually scares me a little bit, because you talk about getting right in the bull's face and kicking it in the nose. We've been doing that with this witch, but she's a criminal and she's got to be opposed. We're fully committed. So I just thank God that we've been so effective. And I want to thank you and just the entire crew, because it's the people behind the scenes who are dedicated to the info war that also put themselves at risk who make all this possible. In fact, they make my job easy, and they never ask for credit, but I just want you to know that we just got some amazing people in the operation. We have seen a Greek tragedy play out in front of us. But if you really know the Greek tragedies, they're not tragedies like Ulysses, when he finally gets back after being gone for decades and all these enemies have taken over his house. Because in the end, it's not a tragedy, because justice prevails. And America has been taken over by criminals. They think it's their country. They've tried to play us off against each other, dumb us down, make us poor so they can control us. And the truth is, they don't rule us because they're strong. They rule us because they're scum and because good people don't think like they do. Well, I'm here to tell you, I've studied the enemy and so have our guest. And we are here educating people about how our enemy operates. And they're going to find out who's strong. And they're beginning to find out who's strong right now. In fact, they've actually always known who's strong. That's why they've done all this, to try to make us weak, try to teach us that we can't fight back. Every time we fight back, we get stronger, they get weaker. Now, Glenn Beck, folks, everybody knows I don't attack other talk show hosts who claim they're patriots. I don't. I'm not in competition with Rush Limbaugh or Sean Hannity. I'm not in competition with any of these people. So I kind of held my tongue with Glenn Beck the last decade, really the last 6-7 years, where he did stuff behind the scenes to my own operation. I even pled with him on air and through his people to stop it. But I told everybody that Glenn Beck is an absolute, total, and complete Benedict Arnold. And when I say Benedict Arnold, I mean he is the living embodiment of it, and so is Megyn Kelly. These people are horrible, hateful, treacherous people. And I am so sad to have to say Ted Cruz is one of them. And he pledged and said he always keeps his word to endorse the nominee, and he said he would do it if it was Donald Trump. Because it would have been so unpopular for him to not say that And then he went back on his word in front of everyone and called it conscience and used the exact same script. He's hired this psychological warfare firm. I'm serious. Look it up. That's known for the biggest disinformation operations you can imagine. That's hired by third world dictators. That's who Glenn Beck and Cruz are having write these scripts that are just upside down land, where he goes on Meet the Press and then Ted Cruz last night with a sabotage operation of vote your conscience, which means vote Hillary. That ought to be her bumper sticker. You know, I mean, this is the most ridiculous garbage I've ever seen. We know Hillary Clinton is a demon. We know Hillary Clinton is an abject criminal, has committed so many crimes, is so dishonorable, is such a nasty monster. And then now we have them trying to thwart the votes of the people. They already stole it from Sanders. And then he has the nerve to get up there like he's some hero and try to shoot down Trump to get brownie points in the future so they'll run him for president. Listen, the whole Bush-Clinton order, the whole old system's going out. We're going to break it all down on the other side. Stay with us. I'm Alex Jones from the RNC, 2016 Cleveland. One of my favorite sayings, I guess, comes from the opening of A Tale of Two Cities, and it was the best of times, it was the worst of times. Really a great spirit of America trying to come back from the dead here in Cleveland. Really great folks. It comes off to me as a working class town, a lot of real people, and the police and everybody that are on the ground. A lot of them are listeners. In fact, I say a lot of them are listeners is an understatement, which again scares the system, because the police and military already know what's going on average. It's the general public that's just starting to wake up, and that's why the globalists are making their move right now. And you have to understand, Ted Cruz's wife was high-level Goldman Sachs, was a high-level neocon operative. And you have to understand that they'd rather have Clintons in, because that's a group they've worked with. These families vacation together. And this is basically the ruling class of this country. And people could say, oh, well, you know, Hillary's not going to be that bad when she gets in. Almost every psychologist, almost every expert says that when she gets in power, she's going to be even more out of control. And so to see Ted Cruz come out and say, hey, I don't endorse people that have attacked my wife and my dad. Well, you sure dropped out of the race a couple days after Roger Stone talked about research into your dad being in New Orleans and knowing Lee Harvey Oswald. You sure dropped out real fast. And of course, your wife has been working in the government and is involved in political statements and is fair game. I mean, people have been attacking Trump's wife every day. That's what happens. And so it's just a big baby up there violating his pledge and reading the exact script that Glenn Beck put out on Meet the Press. This is all scripted. This is all put out by these PR firms. We even know the name of the PR firm. You can go research it for yourself. British PR firm that's involved in the nastiest disinformation you can imagine, trying to overthrow this election, trying to thwart the will of the people. The choice has never been clear. I've never seen the establishment so scared of somebody. And we know this is the establishment that's been running this country and the world into the ground. So later we'll open the phones up and get your take on this, but I'm going to be there tonight. I got a feeling they're going to try some type of stunt. There's Trump's helicopter flying by. It's so surreal. You got jet copters flying around, and you got Air Force Trump, and you've got, it's moving too fast, dude. You're not going to get it. Anyways, it's just surreal. I mean, this whole thing is unreal. I've got a couple of these clips. Let's play the booing again when he says vote your conscience, which means vote Hillary. And then we'll get to the other clip. Here it is.
We will unite the party. We will unite the country by standing together for shared values, by standing for liberty. God bless each and every one of you.
Let's back that clip up to the start, okay? Because that's not the clip. I want to play the clip David Knight played earlier, the one where they booing, and that's where he says, you know, vote your conscience. If we can, let's cue that up and play that.
Stand and speak and. and vote your conscience, vote for candidates up and down the ticket who you trust to defend our freedom and to be faithful to the Constitution.
And there they are booing him. And notice how it's all crafted. He says, oh, vote for people up and down the ticket. He's there at the RNC about to give his speech. And he says, vote for candidates up and down the ticket. Don't vote for Donald Trump, basically. Vote for Hillary Clinton. But he doesn't have the will to come out and say, just go ahead and vote for Hillary. But that's what this is. He weasels it and says, vote for people up and down the ticket. The exact words Glenn Beck said on Meet the Press. Now, there's another clip I want to play, if we can cue that up. And, oh, by the way, we have a Nigel Farage interview about 7 minutes long that the crew got yesterday. Did a great job. And then there's a longer, how long is it, Josh, the full interview with Nigel Farage? No, but I'm told there's a bigger one going up. Yeah, so a big hour one is going to go up very, very soon. We'll also air that here on the broadcast in the coming days, but because we always love talking to Nigel Farage. I got to meet him in person last night, but it must have looked like paparazzi coming down the street because I had a camera crew with me, and I'm like, look, it's him. And then he couldn't see me out in the dark. He like ducked in back in the restaurant, but then I went over there and was able to hang out with him in the restaurant and basically have dinner with him and Roger Stone and others, and a lot of other people, man. It was crazy. To get to meet Nigel Farage. I mean, a guy that's changed the world coming from nowhere. And, of course, the assassination attempts on him and the fact that it's just amazing to be alive and see history unfolding in front of us. We're going to come back. And we are back. Thank you so much for joining us. Look at how the media spins things. RNC protesters are getting vile, New York Post. And then it goes on to say that the protesters were throwing urine on each other. No, we were there, and we talked to the police officers that were at other events. They were throwing urine, the communists and others, and feces at patriots. But every time these anti-Trump people attack somebody, it's always, oh, there was a fight, or there was a scuffle, or there was... No, they almost always initiate everything, and that's documented. Meanwhile, I'm told that Ted Cruz's website's been taken over. And I guess just being more honest, then it says the next president of the United States, Hillary Clinton. I was interviewed yesterday for about 2 minutes by an AOL writer. And he said, do you support Trump's Veterans Affairs coordinator saying that Hillary Clinton should be put before a firing squad? And I said, no, I don't support violence, but I do think she's involved in treason. And so if she was found guilty of treason by a jury, that, you know, she should be punished. I mean, she's a communist Chinese agent. And, of course, I laid out some evidence of that. And it turned into the headline, Alex Jones, you know, says put Hillary in front of a firing squad. I didn't say that. I don't want to turn her into a martyr, ladies and gentlemen. I want to see her not running this country and not running this nation to the ground. I mean, it's one thing, you know, to say you don't like Hillary Clinton. And I totally get that. But it's another thing to actually try to defeat her. And that's something that Donald Trump's trying to do. And believe me, up there on the enemies list, Donald Trump's at number one. And then if you move on down the list, you know, I'll guarantee you, you can find my name on there. And I'm not bragging about that. I'm not even proud of that. I'm just stating a fact that a few years ago, they had news articles about the White House enemies list. And I'm right up there at the top. And you can see that. They run Media Matters, who attacks me every day now. Used to be every other day or once a week. It's every day. With twisted disinformation. Let me tell you, it's creepy to have this White House looking at me. It's like the eye of Sauron looking at me. But you know what? That only empowers me more to take action. It is surreal, though. And again, the only reason I point that out is your voice is needed more than ever, especially when people like Ted Cruz are just so obviously working for the worst sectors of the establishment. This guy is 110% the attempted fourth term of the Bushes, basically. And you can say what you want about George W. Bush. You know, I mean, for all intents and purposes, he didn't even run the White House. But I'm talking about the people behind them. I'm talking about the Rockefeller Republicans. I mean, you know what George Herbert Walker Bush used to call himself, a Rockefeller Republican. You know Newt Gingrich, who talks a really good game, used to work for the Rockefeller Foundation and for Nelson Rockefeller directly. So that whole constellation of neocon rhino Republicans that we can't ever seem to get rid of, that work with the Democrats and help this agenda keep going forward, they do not want Donald Trump. And I know I'm stating the obvious here, but Ted Cruz and others attacked Mrs. Trump. And so the fact that other people out there on social network memes compared Ted Cruz's wife to Trump's wife and said, man, look who looks better. That had nothing to do with Trump. And that all came out. But this is how Ted Cruz plays this part of this big victim. And oh my gosh, you better leave my wife alone or I'll beat you up and all this stupid crap. Now look, Ted Cruz is smart. Ted Cruz is well-spoken. I think Ted Cruz is a great speaker. I admire anybody that can do a filibuster for 26 hours. I don't think I could do it. But he now has joined Glenn Beck and all the rest of these people. And you've got Roger Ailes, you know, out at Fox. And all these people say they're going to leave Fox. I mean, this is a coup of our media in this country. And it's a bellwether. It's a signal. It's a canary in the coal mine, a big canary in the coal mine. That everything we've warned about, that Matt Drudge has warned you about, is now here. And they're coming after talk radio next. And they're coming after you next. They're going to jack your taxes up. They're going to ship what's left of your jobs overseas because the globalists want to break this country's will. This is feudalism. This is how in the old days England controlled Scotland and Ireland. It's how the French would control the different areas in France. It's called feudalism, where they keep you at a subsistence level. This is a 21st century system. And like Diamond and Silk said, we don't want the crumbs anymore. We want the prosperity, and we know it's there. Some of these headlines, I'm going to go to the Nigel Farage interview, at least some snippets of it. Heidi Cruz escorted out following Ted's showdown with Trump. In fact, let's play him talking about his wife, using his wife to act like Donald Trump's attacking women, a total leftist Hillary Clinton playbook. These people are working for Team Hillary.
I am not in the habit of supporting people who attack my wife and attack my father.
I am not in the habit of supporting people that attack my wife and attack my father. Your father was running around coast to coast telling evangelicals they'd go to hell if they didn't vote for you, and Glenn Beck was anointing you as a Messiah figure. And you did get a good maybe 10%, 20% of the evangelicals to think you are God and ready to drink the purple Kool-Aid, you know, at Guyana. But let me tell you, you look and you act more like a devil, my friend, than you do any type of prophet of God. I mean, that really is sick. And then Drudge comes out and just simply points out that you're saying that Donald Trump's the devil. And then Cruz comes out and says Drudge is anti-Christian. Remember that little juicy? Which all Drudge has ever done is focus on the war on Christians and the persecution of Christians worldwide. But see, that's what you get with these people, is an inverted reality. And people are sick of it. I'm sick of it. I'm tired of being misrepresented by these folks. And look, this isn't about setting, you know, scores or vendettas here. I don't want to see Glenn Beck bankrupted. I don't want to see Glenn Beck in the ditch. I don't take pleasure in seeing somebody destroy themselves. But I do need him to get his leg off the country's throat that he's got on the country's throat along with Hillary and the globalists and Obama. And you know, that's why his audience is basically gone. Fox has already lost half its audience in one key demographic and several others, more than 30%. People say, why is Fox doing this? Why are they bashing Trump? Because they're the establishment. And because they have to, even if it destroys Fox News, it's about the whole show. And now, because that won't work, they're killing it in front of you. They're killing a billion-dollar media company. It makes $1 billion a year. It's got more viewers than every other news cable channel combined. The average show has 2 million viewers every hour, and they're killing it in front of everyone. People say, oh good, you'll just get the audience. Oh yeah, we are exploding. We have millions an hour. But we don't sit there and do it all fancy with all these big corporate sponsors. It's fine. Like, I'm proud of the fact that I'm grassroots, but the issue is they're going to come after us next. They're taking down Fox News first, then it's Rush Limbaugh, and all the idiots are going to cheer. So many talk show hosts I know are like jealous. They go, good, I hope they shut down Fox. I hope they shut down Limbaugh. I'm like, are you a moron? You're not in a free country when this type of crap's going on behind the scenes. Next, they're going to start killing us. And then we're going to have to fight back. And then it's the civil war they want. And then we've let them push us into something we didn't want to do. We wanted to fix this country peacefully. But I will tell everybody this. I'm not somebody that shoots my mouth off. Everybody knows that. But I'm not going to sit here and watch people become political prisoners and crap. I mean, it's just not happening. And so I'm here affecting the future information warfare battle space. Just letting everybody know there's a coup going on in America by the criminals that already hijacked it, who are now trying to shut down any opposition because they can't stand against us. They're weak, they're empty, they're hollow, they can and will be defeated if you simply take action. And you saw that crowd almost unanimously boo the fake Texan Ted Cruz. And the reason I say that is everything about him is fake. He wears cowboy boots and blue jeans and cowboy hats when he's in Texas. And we don't allow people in Texas. We don't put up with stuff like that New York Yankee up there. Ooh, this guy's from north of New York. It's disgusting. Again, it's divisional politics. Oh, Trump's attacking women. Oh, Trump doesn't like us Texans. It is so patronizing to people. This guy is all hat and no cattle. It is so frustrating to me. I mean, it really is. It's a get-up. It's an outfit. And all these little Republicans with their Texas shirts on, their Texas hats, selling the idea of authentic Texans. These are not Texans. These are buffoons. And, I mean, I see them on the floor, and I want to absolutely ask them, what is your major problem, man? Don't try to steal the popular vote. You're pledged to come here for Donald Trump. Instead, you want to sabotage it and blow everything up politically for Hillary Clinton. I mean, you are cult members. You are idiots. You are morons. You are shameful. And at least take the Texas shirts off. God, please. I want to vomit. Okay, I want to go to this Nigel Farage clip. We're going to skip this network break so we have more time. Briefly here, we do need funding, obviously. And you can see that we're putting everything to the enemy that we can and really leading the way as an example for others, regardless of whatever happens to InfoWars down the road, to defeat the globalist. But everybody should be spreading the word about the videos, the articles, the information. I know you are. It's having a huge effect. Keep it going. We've got a lot of different specials and discounts. We started being a dealer for Oakley sunglasses and Oakley gear because I love it. And then we have a connection to the folks we get our optics from and things. So I love Oakley. In fact, I have a pair of Oakleys in my bag that I even forgot to bring out of the bag today. Something like 92% of all sunglasses are made in Italy, and that's fine. I'm all for, you know, nice Italian sunglasses, but Oakley's are not. And so, Oakley has a lot of its operations based here in the United States. It's some of the only competition out there. I love it, and I love classic designs by them. I think for the price, they're a lot better than some of the really expensive. Oh, you guys are awesome. We've got a whole crew in here editing and uploading videos, kicking ass, by the way. So sometimes you're going to hear some background noise. And in fact, I almost just have folks talk. I mean, it'd be like in a newsroom, you know, with the typewriters going, to show folks what's going on here as we overlook the convention. But continuing here, I want to go to this report. The fact is, I'm not going to even sit here and belabor the products that are at InfoWarsStore.com, whether it's storable foods, Hillary for Prison shirts, really great optics, G-Shock watches, Oakley products. A lot of times we have some of the lowest prices out there or the lowest. A lot of times we're competitively priced, whether it's our non-GMO seed center, thousands of different items, InfoWarsStore.com, shortwave radio systems, really great solar panel systems and base control units that are hands down for the price, the best bang for your buck you're going to find from our research. InfoWarsStore.com, InfoWarsLife.com, or call toll-free 888-253-3139. And I tell you, we are selling out of the Hillary for Prison shirts as fast as we can get them printed up right here in the good old U.S. of A, because people now see the power of them on the streets. In some cases, a third of the folks in the streets are wearing them here in Cleveland. We're seeing the chants everywhere that are going on all over the place. Is that now in the store? Double check that. Yeah. Thank you. But that's a great point, dude. And you're now seeing the chants on the floor of Hillary for prison, Hillary for prison, Hillary for prison, put her in prison. And it's showing that the RNC would never want somebody like me to go speak in there. I actually wouldn't want to go speak in there because that's still establishment run to a great extent. They always act like I want to get in there. I already was offered the Fox News shows. I've already hosted shows on Discovery Channel and History Channel. I've already been in movies and all that crap. It means nothing. It's this illusion that somehow we're going to arrive. You know, if I could only go speak in there and be on national TV, oh, it would be so wonderful. It doesn't do anything. What I love is seeing Joe Biggs, you know, out there trying to rescue the flag from a bunch of admitted communists that want to overthrow and want to put everybody in forced labor camps in their own manifesto. I mean, this is the hardcore revolutionary Communist Party here in the U.S. I mean, these are nasty people, folks. I love being out here and, you know, being able to try to take the high ground from the communists and, you know, having them attack me and to show what scum they are. I absolutely love being out here with the real people, not all the mummy rhino people that are hanging on by their fingernails to their whole system that's collapsing. And that's what this populism is about. And I know you get that. But I would rather any day just be with the average grassroots hardworking people. I don't care whether they're poor black folks or poor white people or just middle class folks or nouveau riche patriots. I don't care. It's so good to be around real people. It's so good to be around laid back, you know, decent, real people instead of these folks that are absolute mummies. And you look at the liberals, they are a bunch of brainwashed trendies, scared to death, following whatever the latest fad is from The Daily Show. They're a joke. These people are not Americans. These people aren't even really alive or awake, in my view. But let me tell you who is alive and awake. Nigel Farage. Last night at like 9:30, Roger Stone goes, hey, just talk to Nigel Farage. He wants to, you know, have a drink with you. But actually, I'd heard that earlier in the day, but then later, I guess he took a nap. He says, oh, now it's back on. You want to meet him? And so, there's been some other meetings and stuff, but I can't get into those. Some of the stuff, Fight Club, you know, two rules of Fight Club. Don't talk about Fight Club. But this meeting, I mean, I can talk about. But I'm sitting there with my crew in the dark street coming down, and I see Nigel Farage smoking a cigarette with Roger Stone out front. And I go, there he is. Because, you know, for me, it's like a rock star. And this guy really is, you know, changing the face of things and putting up with so many threats and so many death threats. And he's the fastest growing party in Europe, fastest growing party in the UK. It's like Ron Paul / you know, Donald Trump / InfoWars movement against the New World Order. And so, I mean, I'm so excited to, you know, meet a winner like this. And he thinks it's paparazzi or something that kind of runs back in. But then I went down to the basement with him, hung out, and we had dinner down there. And it was really, really amazing to just meet Nigel Farage and the rest of his crew that are just regular people and that have bucked the system and have bucked the demonization and have come through it stronger on the other side. It was really amazing. This is a 7-minute clip. But we got multiple interviews with him. Leanne did, Margaret did, Kit Daniels did, a lot of the folks did. We've got over an hour of footage that's going to be out in the next few days on Nigel Farage getting into so many subjects. But bottom line, we can title this when we re-upload it to YouTube, this particular deal, the George Washington of the UK talks to InfoWars, because this is amazing. And if we make people like Nigel Farage the new rock stars, when our country was really great, it was the trailblazers. It was the trackers. It was the Lewis and Clarks. It was the trailblazers. It was the innovators. It was the inventors that were the stars. And Edward Bernays wrote 1921. You can read it in his book, Propaganda, but he wrote letters in the early 20s that were later put in his book in the 30s, Propaganda, that, hey, we America's great because it's people like George Washington, and it's people like Davy Crockett, and it's people like Lewis and Clark, and it's people like the great inventor that invented thousands of things, and including capturing electricity, you name it. And of course, that was Benjamin Franklin, total genius. And they said, listen, people know how to fix things, they know how to fight, they know how to read, they're totally independent. You don't want that. You want to make it with this new thing called Hollywood. You want to merge that with the politicians and make yourselves the new royalty, have red carpets like your royalty, come in like your God, and then make the people worship you, and then you'll take their culture away from them. And they've done it. That's who they are. Here is the clip.
You bravely led Britain out of the EU. Do you think that Donald Trump could lead that type of resistance here in the U.S.?
That's for you to judge. I don't know the answer to that. I mean, he has taken on the establishment in Washington and inside his own party. And I'm going to be fascinated to see tomorrow what he's got to say and kind of how he says it, too.
Leanne McAdoo with InfoWars.com here in Cleveland covering the Republican National Convention. And we got word that there's a surprise visitor in town. Brexit mastermind Nigel Farage is here. Of course, he played a key role in Britain's decision to leave the EU. We're going to find out if he thinks Donald Trump has what it takes to help lead America outside of the clutches of globalist powers. All right, so talk to me a little bit about the rise in nationalism that we're seeing globally. So many people are saying it's racism, xenophobia, rather than citizens wanting to rise up, reclaim their sovereignty from global powers. So what do you really see is behind Brexit and other countries?
Well, what I've seen is several decades of big politics, big government, treating democracy with contempt, treating anybody that was even vaguely patriotic about their country and their identity as somehow being really absolutely awful. I mean, what a dreadful thing for people to do. I've seen an international political order that has led us into an endless series of foreign wars, which in many cases have made things worse, not better. And at the heart of all of it, corporatism, the big international businesses virtually owning politics, and the rich getting massively richer and the ordinary Joe being left behind. So things have gone badly wrong. And I think people have become very unhappy about this. They recognize this, and they're beginning to find political opportunities to express that. And Brexit was exactly that. Brexit was, despite everybody threatening us, everyone telling us it'd be a terrible mistake, the British people said, to hell with you. We want to take back power over our lives. And that's actually what it's about. That's what this reassertion of democracy is really about.
Right. And we saw so much fear being put out there, so many naysayers, so many doomsayers, really kind of warning the rest of the world, don't you dare think about reclaiming your sovereignty. What do you see would be the effect of Brexit for the world?
Well, what Brexit shows, firstly, is that any campaign can win. Any campaign can win. You can beat the big guys, you can beat the establishment if you inspire ordinary people to engage in a democratic process. That's the first thing. And secondly, I just have a feeling that things aren't ever going to be quite the same again.
Yes.
I think it's such a fundamental, it's not just a British event, it's not just a European event, it is an event of global significance. And that's good. We need change. I mean, unless people think that voting can change things, why would you ever bother to vote?
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. And so now you're here in Cleveland at the Republican National Convention. Donald Trump was just named as the Republican nominee. Are you here to endorse Donald Trump?
No, I'm not. And that would be a terrible mistake. You know, after all, President Obama engaged himself in British politics and had the counter effect. I'm not an American. I'm not an American voter. I'm here watching, a part of your democratic process with great interest. But I'm also here bringing a message from the Brexit campaign that if you can reach the hearts and minds of ordinary people, you can change anything.
And what do you think a Donald Trump administration would bring not only to our relationships with our oldest ally, but to the rest of the world?
Well, I think that remains to be seen. I mean, clearly Trump is fighting on an America First ticket. And there's a feeling that maybe the interests of ordinary Americans need putting higher up the food chain than perhaps they've been under the last couple of administrations. So we'll have to see. As far as we're concerned, I mean, look, let's be honest about it. You know, the UK and the USA, you know, we are pretty much, we have been for a long time, the closest allies in the world. You know, we've stood together through some pretty heavy stuff. And frankly, if we hadn't done that in the 20th century, the world would be a much darker place than it is today. I believe that what we've done is to free ourselves from this political club, and we can now come and talk to you about doing trade deals. We can talk to you, you know, about foreign policy cooperation. There are lots of things we can now have a proper conversation about. And when President Obama said that the United Kingdom would be at the back of the queue, it was an absolutely disgraceful thing to say. And I hope we're somewhere near the front of your queue, or line, as you normally say.
Yes, well, we were all very excited, stayed up late to celebrate along with you all. Now, what advice can you offer us here in the U.S. in regards to open immigration, as well as secret trade deals? Any advice?
Well, the immigration thing is different because your chief problem, as I see it, is actually illegal immigration, whereas ours, oddly, was legal immigration. Ours was the entire European Union being able to come to our country. But you know, the lessons are the same. Unless your citizens feel that you as a government are in control and have a strategy, then they will become contemptuous of you. So different reasons, but similar result. And this stuff does matter to people. It matters to people hugely.
Okay, and one last question. You bravely led Britain out of the EU. Do you think that Donald Trump could lead that type of resistance here in the U.S.?
That's for you to judge. I don't know the answer to that. I mean, clearly, you know, he has taken on the establishment in Washington and inside his own party, and I'm going to be fascinated to see tomorrow what he's got to say and kind of how he says it too.
Now, that's about 7.5 minutes of the interview that is over an hour long. In fact, we had three different reporters talk to him, all these different angles. This is an in-depth Nigel Farage group of interviews that we'll be doling out in the next few days. Now, coming up, we got a bunch of big guests today. We got Milo, who's been banned on Twitter for criticizing social justice warriors, and more coming up. Let's play part of this report that's up on Infowars.com by Paul Watson that's going viral. The truth about Milo is going to be joining us in studio coming up in 1 hour.
Twitter has slapped a lifetime ban on Milo Yiannopoulos for saying that the new Ghostbusters movie sucked and criticizing one of its lead actors, Leslie Jones. According to Twitter, Milo was banned for, quote, inciting or engaging in the targeted abuse or harassment of others. This was parroted by the New York Times, who said that Jones had suffered, quote, racist and sexist remarks rallied and directed by Mr. Yiannopoulos. Time magazine said Milo was, quote, involved in a campaign of racial harassment. TechCrunch said Milo, quote, urged on a hateful mob. BuzzFeed claimed Milo, quote, incited his followers to bombard Jones with racist and demeaning tweets. Yet there's no evidence for this whatsoever. All these media outlets are brazenly lying. This provably never happened. Milo tweeted that Jones was, quote, barely literate. That's it. That's not harassment. It's a statement of fact. And it isn't proof of Milo inciting a targeted campaign of abuse against Jones. There's no proof whatsoever that Milo incited the targeted abuse or harassment of Leslie Jones, who did engage in the incitement of targeted abuse against another Twitter user. Who could it possibly be? And it was Leslie Jones. She sent out a tweet on Monday inciting her followers to target someone with whom she disagreed.
Bitch, I want to tell you about yourself, but I'm gonna let everybody else do it. I'm gonna retweet your hate. Get her!
Get her. That's inciting targeted harassment right there. Under Twitter's own rules, Leslie Jones should have her account terminated. She did the precise thing that Milo was wrongly banned for. She openly incited the targeted harassment of another Twitter user, not to mention engaging in routine casual racism.
But Twitter's a private company. It can refuse service to anyone it likes.
Oh, really? So can Christian bakeries refuse service to gays? Oh, no, that's right, they get fined and shut down.
But that has nothing to do with it. You're talking about discrimination law.
Except that law isn't applied when it comes to Muslim bakeries refusing to bake gay wedding cakes. Just like Twitter's own rules aren't applied to leftists who engage in violent rhetoric or who incite targeted harassment. Do you know how many threats of violence and outright death threats I've personally reported to Twitter, only to see nothing happen every time. So while Twitter was wasting its time and resources on censoring a gay conservative who gave a movie a bad review, ISIS supporters were celebrating terrorist attacks. An actual ISIS jihadist was allowed to threaten terror on Twitter for 6 months, and they did nothing. Over the last 2 years, Black Lives Matter supporters have called for killing police officers on a daily basis. Those threats intensified after the murder of 5 cops in Dallas. How did Twitter respond? It gave them their own emoji. So I guess under these new rules, prominent Twitter users with hundreds of thousands of followers are now personally responsible for racist and violent tweets sent by their followers. Does that mean D-Ray McKesson or Sean King will be held personally responsible for the deluge of violent threats and incitements to kill cops tweeted by Black Lives Matter supporters? Does that mean apologists for radical Islam like Glenn Greenwald will be held personally responsible for ISIS propaganda or death threats sent to conservatives by Islamists?
Is Justin Bieber responsible when his fans cut themselves with the hashtag cut for Bieber? Is Beyonce responsible when her fans go after One Directioners with death threats and rape threats? Of course not. It's preposterous to suggest that a public figure, an entertainment personality, or a prominent journalist is responsible for what other people post on the internet.
Does that mean feminists like Anita Sarkeesian or social justice warriors in general will be held personally responsible?
Very, very powerful report, the truth about Milo. And people say, oh, I don't like Milo, or oh, I like Milo. It doesn't matter. The fact that they can permanently ban him off Twitter is dangerous for everybody. Our guest coming in right now as we overlook the RNC. I'm going to be going down through Media Row today and looking at some of the dinosaur media, some of the specimens there. Regardless of what you think of some of the politics of some of the folks we're going to be having on today, like Milo Yiannopoulos. This guy has tens of millions of Twitter followers, or did. He's a successful entrepreneur who happens to be gay. And since he criticized the new Ghostbusters movie as a feminist propaganda being forced down our throats, they, quote, permanently banned him for inciting racial or ethnic hatred. And now they can ban anybody else. And the next, they're going to try to pass all these anti-hate laws, which are meant to only target conservative or libertarian or patriotic speech. These people want to shut down our speech. We have a coup going on at Fox News right now. I was told about this last year and 2 weeks ago. I conferred with Stone. He confirmed, yes, it is a coup made up because Roger Ailes hugged Megyn Kelly 6 years ago and might have squeezed her a little too hard. And so sexual harassment. And so now the Murdochs, who run all their other leftist media, are basically kicking him out to take it over. They've already lost half their ratings in key demographics. Sean Hannity and 30 other hosts and crew are saying they're getting ready to leave. And I talked to other Fox executives yesterday when I was over at the Ritz-Carlton doing a pre-interview with Milo. And I talked to him in the bar area. I was talking to some well-known Fox people. I'll just leave it at that. They confirmed everything I was told by the Fox host I know. So this is a reign of terror against free speech going on, a leftist coup in the few areas of media that are not completely anti-American. So this is getting crazier and crazier. And the answer to this is for everybody to start getting their own local show, running for office, getting aggressive. Normal people don't want to be in power. We just want to live our lives. Well, I'm sorry. Collectivist, globalist, socialist, you name it, they want power. They're taking over. And it's now time to really launch a populist movement against them. That's what you see Donald Trump doing. You see Nigel Farage, who we just interviewed, breaking down with the Brexit. This is happening. And somebody else who's fighting at the local level is Captain Higgins. I wanted to get this guy on last year when this broke. And then obviously it's hard to get through channels of somebody when the whole media is calling you. But then I ran into some folks that work with him. He's running for Congress. And I said, oh, my gosh, give me that card. Let's get him in studio. Because right when all this cop killing accelerated, and then the cops were, like, apologizing in liberal areas, we'll do better, and, you know, all the rest of this, please don't kill us. This guy came out and said, look, we're just going to kill you. You try to kill us. We're coming after you. And, of course, he then got in political trouble about that. Again, because this is upside-down bizarro world. So CaptainHiggins.com, I'm not going to go over his whole bio, but remember he was going after the Gremlin gang that was killing people down in Louisiana. Captain Clay Higgins is a lifelong resident of Louisiana. He has served in Arcadia. My eyes are going bad today in this bright light. In law enforcement for the last 11 years and currently serves as deputy marshal for the city of Lafayette, Captain Higgins has become one of the nation's most influential cops, regularly speaking to law enforcement agencies across America. And I'm not going to go over all of his bio, but I love seeing folks out there like the Milwaukee sheriff and others and yourself who just tell it like it is. Good to have you here, sir.
Al, it's just such an honor to be here, man. I can't tell you what a big fan I am of yours. We don't always agree, but we always agree that you are on point, baby. You're the point of the spear, and your thrust is felt across the world. So thank you for having me here. And you're right, man. I was listening to what you're saying. We're certainly, listen, thieves in suits have seized power in Washington, D.C., and in other capitals across the world. The sun does not set on the insidious effort to divide us whereby they can control us. And Alex, you're completely right, partner. I agree with you 100%. American citizens must stand up. We must vote. We must run for office. We must leave our comfort zone. For me, that's a street cop. I've been a street cop for 13 years. I was thrust into the national spotlight, and somehow or another, you know, by the grace of God, I became popular and well-known. But this was not something that I sought, you understand? Not something that I was looking for in my life. But I'm definitely responding to the call to duty.
Well, there's a vacuum, and men are going to fill it.
Yeah, no doubt. That's right. We're going to stand this country back up, whether the people that have taken it over like it or not. And you know, we have to.
I like how you say that. We're going to stand the country back up.
That's right. We're going to stand this thing back up. And we're going to do it not by politicians, you know, not by the insidious agenda of those with the unbelievable lust for greed and power, but by the patriotic fervor and the bond of our American spirit.
Talking about spirit, I can feel your spirit right here. Used to, I go to RNCs, kind of felt creepy, kind of neocon rhino. I felt a really good spirit in there the last few days. But out on the street with the citizens and the police and everybody together, I really have never felt the spirit of America stronger. It's incredible.
Neither have I. You know, we've been patient. We've been loving. We're forgiving. We're quiet. This is the nature of the conservative. This is the nature of the libertarian. We allow each other our freedoms, and that includes their freedom to oppress us to a certain point. You know, we have reached that point. We've passed that point. Our nation is in peril. When I served my country as a military police officer, I swore an oath to the United States Army to defend my nation against all enemies, foreign and domestic. There's no expiration date on that oath, and I continue it to this day, as do you, sir.
Well, I tell you, nobody's perfect, and there's, as they say, bad apples anywhere, but I am blown away. I've got to say 90% of the military is completely awake and about 80% of the police. People say, well, there's still some bad cops. You know, why are you? Look, we've got George Soros and foreign interests trying to cause a civil war on record, targeting local government and police. That is a foreign attack on this country when they attack the police and local government. It's a no-brainer. We've got to back the police now to the hilt. This is a foreign attack. That's not rhetoric.
You're right, brother. We're under attack, but I'm going to tell you something. Those that attack us, listen to me well. This will not end the way you think it will. Because my brothers and sisters of the thin blue line will not waver from our loyalty and our service to the Constitution that we're sworn to uphold and to the citizens that will give our last blood.
You just said it. They want you to stand down and let them take over.
That's right. That's not happening, baby. You know, from sea to shining sea.
Why have they miscalculated? It's so clear to me it's going to blow up in their face.
Because they're idiots. This is why they've proven that they're idiots. They continue to underestimate the common man because they consider us uneducated. They consider us not their equal. They're very erudite, you know, and their level of unbelievable destruction for our country, their intent to destroy our country, completely overlooks our superior intent to defend and uphold our country. Because they think they're better than we are, but they're not.
And the sleeping giant never wakes up until it's under attack.
That's right.
You're right, though. They are so arrogant. I ran into Charlie Rose, the big Bilderberg arrogant, group member, man. And he was evil. I mean, when I was talking to him last night, his eyes were like snake eyes. We haven't aired that yet. And these people really think they're better than us. But you know what? I wish they were still arrogant. They're starting to realize that America's waking up. I think they're concerned now.
Yeah, they should be concerned because, listen, the Constitution serves us all, Alex. You know that. And we have learned and grown as a nation and come together through all types of horrors, some horrors of our own creation. But by the bond of our American spirit, we have always united in times of crisis, and this is certainly one. We face a crisis the level of which I don't believe we have faced as a nation.
Yeah, I've never felt the American spirit this strong in this city. It's unbelievable. I mean, I've been very emotional the last few days because it's strong. And I think that's because the country's about to really get challenged. We know they've brought in a bunch of ISIS teams. We know they're being protected. And I just want Obama and the globalists to know when these people start hitting us even harder, you're going to get the blame. They're crazy. How do they think they're not going to get away with this? It's crazy.
Well, again, they continue to underestimate the power and the love of the American people and the spirit that bonds us as one. You know, that's essentially
where do you
message.
Think this is going when you talk to other police around the country as you travel and talk to these groups? What's the kind of crowd source sense, you know, the knowledge of the crowd of these patriots, these warriors, of where this is going and what the next shoe to drop is? Because I can just feel it in the air, the energy.
Yeah, they're going to try. There's going to be other attacks and whatnot. But you know, the more they attack us, the more we bond together. And speaking for my brothers and sisters of the Thin Blue Line, patriots, prior military, current military, serving, man, we number in the millions, you know, across this country. And we have our means by which we communicate through social media. They can't take that away from us. Even if they break down the grid, you know, it's just not going to work. So whatever type of attack ISIS intends to visit upon us will only be successful within the small parameters of the immediate area of that attack. They're not going to crack us because we're unbreakable. We're an irresistible force. The power of the American people will not be subdued. We shall overcome, and we must take back Washington one election at a time, one candidate at a time that speaks from his heart.
That's right.
One patriot at a time, baby. We're going to take this thing back.
How do we get you into Congress? I'd love to have you in there.
Your love and prayers and support, CaptainHiggins.com. is my my campaign congressional website. I am not a politician. I never will be. I'm a patriot.
Straight shooter.
This is a call to duty for me.
There were attempts to silence you. Those haven't worked, obviously.
Yeah, good luck with that. Yeah, that's not going
to
work.
Speaking to other groups around the country, what is the sense of things? Because, I mean, this is a coordinated offshore globalist plan allied with Islam to come in and destabilize the country. But the plan is now known, but they still seem to be following the plan, even though it's going to blow up in their face.
Well, that seems to be their trajectory. You know, the evils that are aligned against us, they can bring what they want. It's just not going to work, brother. You know that. We Americans are not going to sit idly by and allow our country to fall. We have been patient. We have been quiet. We have been loving and forgiving because this is our nature of a good, God-fearing, tax-paying, hard-working American citizen, conservative man, you know, a conservative woman and family. We have conservative ideals, which includes forgiveness and quiet. But when we reach a point where we know that our families are threatened, that our streets are threatened, that the very future of our nature has been threatened, then we bond together. And at this time, and I felt the same spirit in the Cleveland. I met probably 200 cops in the last 48 hours. And man, we have hugged and wept. And these guys will not bend. We will not break, and we will not allow our country.
Absolutely. America's got its problems, but this is an offshore attempt at civil war, and the American people are coming together, every race, color, and creed, against this.
That's right.
This is an epic time. Final segment with our guest coming up to talk about where he sees this election going and Donald Trump and more. CaptainHiggins.com. Stay with us. Captain Clay Higgins, he is our guest for another 6 minutes. Then we've got Latinos for Trump coming in here. Really powerful info they've been putting out. CaptainHiggins.com. Then we have Milo, who has officially been banned for life from Twitter for criticizing the new feminist movie Ghostbusters. I mean, that's his free speech. That's racial or sexual hatred. So they're really trying to shut down free speech. Meanwhile, they have national TV leftists and people calling for my arrest, saying I should be shut down. These people are authoritarians. You know, that shows they're losing, though, Captain, that they're really trying to have it to shut down free speech.
Yeah, they're desperate. But, free speech, you know, our First Amendment, man, is going to stand strong, whether they like it or not, because we now have the means by which to communicate outside of the parameters of the controlled media, you know, the in-the-box media. You know, we can communicate through the airwaves, through social media, and means by which it was just unprecedented.
And good luck trying to shut it down.
Yeah, good luck shutting that down. That's
by the way, you gave me this really nice armband here. It says Redemption on it. CaptainHigginsGear.com.
Yes, sir. Well, that's reflective of a a charitable endeavor we have to build a homeless shelter, man. I'm passionate about the homeless and believe in the redemptive nature of every human being. You know, I'm certainly, my story is an open book, and I'm certainly reflective of that type of redemptive nature. And I believe our country is there, Alex. I gave you that because our country is at a crucial point right now. This election in November will determine whether or not we shall be a redeemed country or not. And that's how important it is. And that's why I believe the election is going to turn out with President Trump.
Wow. I used to really like Ted Cruz. I was really ashamed last night when he wouldn't endorse Trump. I mean, he just shouldn't have spoken.
Man, I have to be honest. That's, you know, that's my nature. I'm a candid person. You presented this to me on the air now. And my nature is to respond from my heart. I was hurt, man, because I love Ted. I actually met the man yesterday, and you know, we had a moment, man. We shared a moment, two patriots, and I completely expected. My friends back home have been texting me from across the country. Captain Higgins, do you think he's going to endorse Trump? I said, of course he is. He's a man of character, and you know, we understand. You know, we take our licks, we get our ass whipped, we stand up, and we continue to move. And I really, really was hurt that he fell short of that. So that's that important, crucial moment. You know, we all have defining moments in life, and we either define them or they define us. And I believe last night that moment defined him.
Unfortunate. In the last 3 minutes we have left, other points you want to break down? You were telling me during the break about the death threats. They told you don't come here. You know, we've got a red dot on you, all these other, you know, intel info coming in. We had all that same stuff. Instead, this is some of the smallest amount of protests by the communists we've ever seen. They're pathetic. It looked like it was all bluff. Now, the day's not over, but I tell you, we got trash trucks and other stuff have disappeared. But I tell you, it just shows that their intimidation isn't working.
Yeah, it's not. And it can be a bluff or not. Makes no difference to me. It's not going to end well for them because the American people are just not going to tolerate that kind of oppression anymore. You understand? We will stand our country back up, and it's going to have, it begins again, one candidate at a time, one patriot at a time, embracing the path that's been prepared for us because, you know, our forefathers for 235 years, we've had patriot bloodshed to get this thing to where it is. Have we been perfect? No. But you can rest assured that we're going to continue moving forward as an American.
And
people.
I like the historical term you use about we're going to stand America up. I never heard anybody use that term, but like an army stands up, a company stands up, a family stands up. I mean, the globalists have sabotaged. People think it's hard to be prosperous. No, Americans have always been the most prosperous. We have to get them off our back. We will automatically, like a jack-in-the-box, stand right back up.
That's right.
And that's it. Stand America back up.
That's what we intend to do.
Explain what that term means militarily.
It's what, well, you know, if you stand up a force, then that means the enemy's in a bind. And right now, the enemy is overseas, and it's within our borders here. We have enemies, you know, foreign and domestic, that we face. And every American can do their part by participating in this election in November.
Americans have to stand up.
The Americans must stand up. We must go to the polls. We must vote. We must take back our neighborhoods.
Get aggressive.
We don't have to tolerate the kind of violence and hateful rhetoric that's taken over our streets. You know, our police officers are getting murdered while we sit in our squad cars. The American
it shows
citizens,
the disconnect that Obama comes out and says cops need to reform every time cops get killed, implying random dead cops are at fault for something else that happened. That is crazy.
And gun control. Of course, we just couldn't wait for his next speech about gun control after more cops were murdered, right? That's really the leadership that we needed. Right
after
now.
They incite it, CaptainHiggins.com. Clay Higgins, thank you, my friend. Look forward to
thank you,
speaking
Alex.
To you again in the future.
Yes, sir. God bless
wow.
you, sir, in your endeavor.
Thank you. All right, we're going to go to break. I'm going to say bye to you. We've got more folks coming in. And then he's been censored, Milo. I mean, they have lifetime banned for criticizing the movie Ghostbusters. God almighty, I tell you. They can do that to him. They can do it to anybody. I'm Alex Jones, InfoWars.com.
Still here so early on, but I think Trump is going to win. Again, let me tell you. It's going to be the Brexit strategy. The middle of England is Michigan, Wisconsin, right. Ohio, and Pennsylvania. And Mitt Romney lost by 64 electoral votes. The total electoral votes of those four states in the Rust Belt, 64.
Yeah.
All he has to do is win those four states. And I'm telling you, I was there during the Michigan primary, and he went there in front of a Ford, and he said, I'm telling you right now, they moved this factory to Mexico. I'm putting the tariff on the cars, and that's it. And it was music to people's ears, and more people in Michigan in the Michigan primary voted Republican than Democrat in the primary this year.
And folks, we are back live. So many great people here. So many big interviews we've got stacked up that we've already taped. When I confronted Charlie Rose, I talked to Don King last night, and we've got so much coming up. But this is live in studio. Marco Gutierrez and Marco Leo, official Latinos for Trump.com. Talk about amazing folks. Coming here legally is what Mr. Gutierrez did, becoming a citizen. That's what Trump's always said, is that it's so hard to become a citizen because the Democrats and Republicans want a bunch of undocumented people that they can basically use and basically drive down the wages with. So we're not the enemies of all these undocumented illegals that are here. They're just being used as a weapon against everybody. And then if the U.S. collapses into a third world country, there's nowhere to go. This is what Ross Perot exposed. He said they're paid $25 an hour, $30 an hour in Canada. We're paid $18 an hour here. As soon as we opened up to Canada, theirs all went down. Now we do it to Mexico, we're going to go down. It happened. And so it's stupid. I mean, we need to be using our jobs industry here to actually build up deals with Mexico, not the other way around, just imploding all of our nations. So official Latinos for Trump.com. Guys, tell us your story. Tell us about what you've been through supporting Trump, where you see all this going, and why you've decided to support Trump. But first, tell us your story. You were telling me your personal story.
Well, my name is Marco Gutierrez, and I was born and raised in Mexico, and I came to this country in 1991. My parents were granted amnesty in the Reagan administration, so they petitioned for us, and I was there with 4 years without my parents. I stayed in Mexico while we got approved.
Sure. Just scoot in a little bit. I'm sorry, I said scoot down.
We got approved. I came, and I have had the opportunity to integrate into this culture, and it hasn't been easy. And I see a lot of people that are having a hard time, that they come here and they stay in the middle, and they live in a subculture environment where they don't feel the urgency or the need to become a citizen, and they cash their checks at the Mexican market. They go to church in Spanish, so they don't feel that need. And Mexico is a country under development, underdeveloped country. So the third world mentality, we bring that with us. And I think that's what Donald Trump's talking about. We have problems. We're bringing problems. But as you integrate in the culture and you understand, then you start seeing the rules and you start getting the idea of what it is to be an American. I came here to be an American. I didn't come here to continue to be a Mexican. And that attitude that you have in San Jose about the flag and La Raza is the ones that have been pushing things on the Hispanics that is not right. You know, the white man with blue eyes is the devil. And when you tell that to kids, and the false pride that comes with that, and they're trying to defend a Mexico that doesn't exist. That Mexico they're defending here is a Mexico of 150 years ago. And there's a lot of unresolved pain that they keep cultivating when this is different times, different problems.
I mean, look, it's Ford Foundation. There's beefs on both sides. Everybody's done bad stuff. But it's Ford Foundation weaponized garbage to make us all fight to keep people in a subculture, as you said, controlled by the Democratic Party. So, I mean, I wouldn't even be against even more massive immigration because, quite frankly, a lot of Americans have gotten lazy, and I don't care what color they are. But the issue is that they get here, I don't care whether they're from China or Europe or wherever, they're indoctrinated with socialist brainwashing and hate America garbage to bring the country down. And I'm sorry, that's my issue. And so that's why it's so great, because I see these stereotypes that Hispanics are all communists or socialists. I find them to be the most patriotic white people out there. Same thing with black folks. We have rallies where it's like almost all blacks and Hispanics and not even white people. They actually care about freedom. And I'm not trying to be patronizing or virtue signal. It's a fact. It's what we're seeing. So what I'm saying is, from what the real people believe and stand for and what the media claims people stand for is two different things. So what do you think the demographics are? How many folks, let's say from Mexico, do you think kind of halfway understand what's going on? Or are they just kind of kept in their barrio?
You have what's called a lot of Donald Trump supporters that are in the closet, and they're afraid to come and say it publicly because of the violent criticism of the left. You have the, I wish there was two or three Alex Jones in Spanish. Maybe I can.
We need it. Maybe no, I can make one. We want to launch a whole Spanish division. That's not the money or the. We're looking. In fact, that's a plan.
I am so against Jorge Ramos, George Lopez. I do videos just.
I know. Viral.
Because these guys, they.
I should add, you reach millions of people. You're, yeah.
They exploit the heritage just to enrich themselves. And they're just hurting all these kids by continuing that nonsense that it just. That's it's not conducive. I think that they're interfering in the integration, cultural integration of thousands of millions of people.
And creating division.
Exactly.
Because let's be honest, it's not just LaRosa teaching hate and stuff. It's causing a backlash on the other side. It's very distasteful.
In the media, I was trying to talk to CNN and Univision yesterday. 90%, it's just the socialist mumbo jumbo.
And a lot of Latinos are really... pro-capitalism. A lot of Latinos are pro-capitalism at heart. You see the guys that are cutting people's yards. You got guys that are selling ice cream, you know, at the corner, and they have fruit stands, and you know they're
old-fashioned common sense hard work.
Yeah, they're not relying on the government.
And mom and dad and family, the opposite of what the socialists. Yep. That's what I mean. How could they sell, especially to Hispanics, who are like the most pro-family people out there? How are they trying to sell socialism to them and anti-family?
It doesn't work. I mean, we like taco truck. We like the tamales. We sell. We like trade. And when the Spanish conquered Mexico, they wrote back to Queen Elizabeth and they said, "Hey, we found this place with riches where there's trade compared to the China's."
Yeah.
And still to this day, that's what we like. We don't like free lunch. We like to work.
But you've always had just like we've had in the U.S. colonialism. And so it'd be great to see colonialism, now we have this corporate colonialism, this socialist colonialism, finally get rid of it.
Sorry.
But Latinos are definitely, you know, not communists, but they're definitely, you know, capitalists at heart. And, you know, some of them in wherever they came from, they've been in their countries, you know, brought into the more communistic, socialistic, you know, styles of living. They get here and they see, you know, this brand of car or that house or whatever, and they have this entitlement feeling that, hey, I should have that car and I should have that and I should have a free education. And a lot of times they do. And you know, I was talking to other, minorities, and, you know, some of them are supporting Donald Trump because, you know, because the Latinos have embedded themselves into the, into the government as well, you know, running the HUD homes. And that's why, you know, they're upset because, hey, you have to be a Latino just to get a Section 8 house. But if you're not Latino, then, and that's actually bringing in like a black hole.
So every group in history does this entitlement business.
Yes.
And does this inside, privilege thing. Instead of just making our culture be about the Bill of Rights, Constitution, free market, family.
Correct.
No matter what color we are, where we came from, we believe in the prosperity of an open, free society. But we can't bring folks in who are going to be weaponized against that free society, and that's happened.
Well, yeah. One thing that in 1986, 4 million... Reagan granted 4 million people passage here to be legalized here.
That includes my stepfather, by the way.
Out of those 4 million, I'm probably the only one that's in the convention today. Where are those people? They should be jumping up and down, registered Republican, to pay back that they're able to be here, but they're not. So we did something wrong then. And a lot of people tell me, well, if you're Mexican, you came here to amnesty, why are you against these people getting legalized? Different times, different problems, and different solutions.
Well, the thing is, the Republicans did that, and the Democrats are so good at race baiting, it doesn't matter what they do, it just gets worse and worse, where you're being called all these names no matter what you do, and at a certain point you're like...
They call us racists, and it's...
Yeah, like, so what is that like? Because, you know...
Oh, it's terrible. You know, obviously, I'm white. You know, my parents, they come from Mexico. They came here legally. They needed the math knowledge from my dad, you know, and he worked on the space program. So he came over here legally, and, you know, his parents, you know, descended from Spain. And so, the Mexicans, they're like, oh, he's American already, so they didn't want me. The blacks, I'm obviously not black. And, you know, the whites, they didn't assimilate me because, you know, I'm an ESL person. You know, I didn't learn English until 6 years old. So I had a lot of racism thrown at me.
Oh, Beth, we're growing, from all sides.
From all sides.
That's me. I love black folks, but I mean, some of them are really racist and aggressive. I grew up in Dallas and I've been attacked, I mean, a lot. I mean, they've been a movie just of that. People wouldn't believe it. And that I don't have some chip on my shoulder against random black people who are great folks, but, you know, it's like they act like only a minority can go through racism, but you're saying you were getting it from all sides, whites, Hispanics, blacks, everybody. Yep. So I mean, well, that's, people are tribal. You know, you're not in their group, you're not in the club.
Yeah. So that's actually helped me become who I am, you know, a stronger individual.
I agree. The stuff I went through made me stronger. It didn't make me a victim.
Nope, it didn't. And, you know, I've been prosperous in my life, and, you know, I'm, you know, whether, you know, good or bad, I'm going to land okay because I have a good head on my shoulders, and you know, I have strong feet.
And you're independent. Imagine
very independent.
Imagine the enslavement of actually believing you can only get ahead with the government. Communist countries can't even build cars.
No, that's
crazy. They never even have enough food.
Look at Cuba.
I mean, take the Russians. Those are probably one of the highest IQ groups out there statistically. Some engineers, scientists, you know, art, music, you name it. Under communism, they couldn't even hardly produce automobiles or enough food. Right. It's ridiculous.
And now they just released an airplane that rivals the 737, the MC-21. Just
absolutely
came out. Yeah, and it's got anti-suicide pilot technology written into it. It's already can be flown as a drone, but they're not getting that certified yet.
That's right. Well, I mean, the point is no matter who you take. They took black folks and put them under government control out of one evil into another and totally destroyed their family in 30 years. Blacks had lower illegitimacy than whites in the 40s and 50s. Now it's the worst in the world. Yeah. You put Russians under government, they're done. You put blacks under government, they're done. You take anybody, put them under government, they're done.
They're done.
Yep. I mean, you put them under socialism, it's over.
They overregulate everything.
Well, yeah, because you never get a chance to actually live or try and fail. Oh, kids, we can't. Everybody has to get an A+, so there's no more grades. Or we can't have dodgeball. Or we can't have trophies because everybody's got to get one.
Yeah.
I mean, it's crazy.
If everybody's a winner, then everybody's on the same level. Nobody gets ahead. But a lot of people get left behind.
Absolutely. And of course, there's always the few winners in the government system who they want to get in the little places of power. But it's crazy. And again, I'm not even saying the government itself's evil. I'm saying a big, overreaching, giant government. But I tell you guys, what type of response have you got when you say folks are closeted? Because that's what I find, is that I think Trump's going to win a landslide. Most people I talk to who are white, black, Hispanic, most folks I know, a lot of folks are mixed, whatever you call it, just humans, they're supporting Trump. You know how liberal trendies are, but they're scared to say it.
There was this, I was at a grocery store, and you know, I was getting signatures for Trump, and you know, this lady who didn't speak a lick of English, she starts speaking to me in Spanish, and she basically is like, yeah, I'm a Trump supporter, doesn't speak English, is registered to vote. She says that the Democrats really have, you know, allowed demonic forces into their party.
I think people are getting it. Carson said it's the devil. He, Hillary's mentor, pledged himself to Lucifer.
Yep. And she pointed out
that there's a problem that I want to talk to about. Now, talking about the problems that we as underdeveloped culture bring. The number one epidemic in the Hispanic community right now is domestic violence. A lot of these people get deported because they haven't got their citizenship. So what you have here is it costs about $50,000 to deport somebody without any legal entanglements around it.
Gosh.
Now, you deport the person, now the family goes in assistance. That's about another $50,000 because it'll take about a year for the guy to get enough money to come back. So now you have $100,000 on somebody that's not doing what he's supposed to do. That's not abiding by the rules of the land.
Yeah.
So these people need to either they need to either integrate or they need to find another.
No, I agree. We need to just vet people, and if they have skills and if they have a good record, just. And I'm sorry, you have people in the citizenship test. They're patriots. You know, they at least are Americana. And see, that sounds wrong to me to say they've got to have a political pro-America view. But then I realize instead they're giving them a globalist communist view. So I'm saying don't indoctrinate people, but then they're going to do it anyway. So how do you counter that?
Well, something that your guest before was saying is I have, when you get your citizenship, you actually have an oath where you an oath to uphold the Constitution and an oath to go against domestic and foreign terrorists.
So I guess becoming a citizen really is you agree to be at least swear to this indoctrination. I mean, that's it. You're joining this crew. You're joining this club. We want free market, religious freedom. We're going to do all this. Why wouldn't you want to say that place to that?
And to answer your question, how do you counter that? You know, I look at the whole Soviet Union when they went to glasnost, and that's what people need is glasnost, freedom, deregulation, empowerment. And that's how you counter it. And right now it's a tough job to try to get to that point. You know, even on the platform, I read the entire thing. There's a lot of wonderful stuff. And then there's some stuff it's not just regulation, but it's over-regulation.
That's right, over-regulation. It's all sorts of garbage because all these special interests can come in, they can buy off the government and then basically have their industry protected. And that's really, and now they want to just shut down free speech. You know, this Milo guy is about to be here, you know, tens of millions of Twitter followers until now, banned. Tech company guy sells it, happens to be, you know, gay or whatever. And he criticizes feminism, and now they've said you're banned for life because that's hateful. I mean, nobody's safe. This is they have a coup at Fox News right now. I mean, they're making their move because they know America and the world is waking up. Gentlemen, stay with us. We're going to come back. What's the best website for folks to visit?
OfficialLatinosForTrump.com.
OfficialLatinosForTrump.com. These gentlemen are reaching tens of millions of people a week. It is amazing. They are incredible. We got 6 minutes left. Marco Gutierrez and crew here. Also, Marco, you got the floor. Other key things you've seen, what you've seen here, what's coming up. You're telling me about the parties with the delegates, other interesting things. You witnessed, you told me about splits in families. You said you have friends and family where the wife threatens to leave the husband. We vote Trump. I mean, this is crazy.
Well, I talk about immigration a lot because... I came here with a dream, an American dream, and I have had actually a very successful story because I became a millionaire in 2007. I went bankrupt and I lost everything. And then I see that if you really want to, this land is the land of opportunity. I mean, it just.
And let me guess, I bet you've already built it back up.
It's I'm getting there. But this.
Where else can you do that?
Nowhere else but the USA.
And not anymore if they keep doing this.
Yes.
There is a lot of people out there that are angry of people that are successful. And I think that's why I'm so angry about Donald Trump. My culture is divided because being an immigrant is not easy. You know, you it's like you get transplanted. And you're
and you get pissed on some. That happens to everybody.
Yeah. But there is a point where you have to have integrity, you know, and you are here, and this is the land, this is the flag we have allegiance to, and the what I'm feeling from look at I'm talking America's being great for me again now. I'm talking to Alex Jones. I was at the floor with a Latinos for Trump sign, and I think that that's gonna give permission to a lot of Hispanics to say, well, I can do that too, and it's okay. It's okay to support Donald Trump.
And it's okay to be open about it, too. That's
well, look, I want to believe in Trump, but I know this. Hillary is pure evil. There's no choice here. What did you think of Ted Cruz? I used to really admire him saying he'd vote for Trump, pledging, and then flip-flopping on there. I really feel sorry for him.
I was totally ready with the Latinos for Trump sign down on the floor. You know, all Latinos unite. All the Latinos unite with Donald Trump. And I was expecting that, and you know, he was saying a lot of great things, you know.
And he slipped it in there.
And then vote your conscience, and which, to some degree, yeah, I guess. But
up and down, all the votes are for Hillary. We don't vote for Trump.
Exactly. Or the others. It's like, look at others. I'm like,
you should have just said vote for Hillary. Said it was all sneaky. Oh, and same thing Lynn Beck said. That PR firm wrote that.
Yeah. So I'm like, where's the olive branch? Where's the endorsement that he said that he would do? You know, this morning I was watching
a sucker punch.
Yeah, this morning I was watching the coverage, and you know, he addressed the Texas delegation, and they said, we came here as delegates for Cruz, and we're leaving delegates for Trump.
And so it backfired on him. But I told folks they were going to walk out Wednesday and Cruz's speech didn't happen. We told everybody that was coming.
Tell them what your dad said.
Oh, my dad told me something about saying in Mexico that some people, they like to burn their house just to see your Scotch fire.
Yeah. Say it again.
Some people burn their houses just to see your house catch on fire.
Exactly.
And I think
so. He cut his nose off in spite of space.
Yeah.
Yep.
So he burned himself up, hoping it would get Trump.
Yes, yep. I think that's exactly. He did. And you know, he's Hispanic, and I'm going back to something. I have tried to not think with the color on my skin because that's what the left is teaching everybody. I've tried.
And then it makes the right start doing it too. But you were mentioning his wife and all these immigrants they marry, and the Trump, and how they hire all these minorities. And Trump, a lot of people that know Trump, he loves everybody.
Well, I never supported Cruz or Rubio. I support Trump because he has. I think that the Vicente Fox, the former president of Mexico, was saying that Donald Trump was the false prophet, and I did a video against him and say, you know.
Listen, brother, we're going to have you back up next week. God bless. We got Milo coming up. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for having us.
Great job, guys.
This is GCN.
This is their website.
The Genesis Communications
Radio. OfficialLatinosForTrump.com.
Yeah.
Milo Yiannopoulos, with his tens of millions of Twitter followers and a successful entrepreneur, it keeps getting censored for just mild things. I mean, this is pretty mild stuff, he says. He calls himself the dangerous faggot. Because, I call him a classical liberal. I'm a classical liberal. I'm into more freedom. Doesn't mean I have to adopt what everybody else is doing. But at the same time now, they have banned him for life on Twitter. It's one of the biggest stories in the world. On DrudgeReport.com, New York Times, you name it. I didn't realize he's not giving them interviews. He just came here, and this interview's coming up after the break. So we're going to tweet that out. Exclusive statement on him being banned for life. This is crazy. Paul Watson's done a powerful video on it. The truth about Milo. I need to get that out. Joe Biggs, separately, you've been attacked, you've been burned, you've had to file police reports, they've arrested them by the communists. I got attacked by the communists. There's a coup at Fox News. I mean, are we in the middle of a coup against America right now?
I was actually just standing downstairs, and there was a whole bunch of guys with, like, red bandanas, and they were looking at me, pointing at me, like, that's him. I'm like, yeah, I'm the guy that's taking your leader down. I'm the guy that's going to sit here and make sure that this communist bastard.
Well, this is all over. Let's just go out and find these guys.
Yeah, I'm down.
We're in trouble, but screw you, commies. You don't scare us.
So either way, I stopped the guy who was trying to light our flag on fire, and I tried to put it out in my hand, burnt my hand. I ripped the guy's shirt off. There was a huge scuffle. Cops on horses coming in. I mean, there was like over 1,000 people in this little circle right here on the road. And it was intense, man. There was the flags going all over the place. We're trying to put it out. This guy's down on the ground, and it was 13 commies got arrested. So all in all, it's a pretty good day.
Well, I mean, the point is they attack people and then say they aren't. And they're out there trying to incite a riot, clearly, in front of a bunch of veterans burning an American flag.
Well, this guy's been known. He's a habitual, dirtbag. He's everywhere.
Same thing with this Dix guy. Everywhere he goes, there's bad stuff the next few days.
Yeah, Carl Dix. This guy's Gregory Johnson. He's a douchebag. And he goes everywhere and incites violence. He was in Ferguson, Baltimore. He's a guy that goes out there with the megaphone, gets everybody riled up, and then when, stuff hits the fan, he walks off and sits back and kind of smiles and lets everyone else go to jail. This time, it came to him.
Well, overall, I've never felt the spirit of America rising stronger. It actually freaks me out. I mean, I've been very emotional. You guys know that behind the scenes, especially just seeing this country awaken, but also see the threat and how close this horse race is between Hillary and these fake New York Times articles, 78% chance she's going to win. Total bull, man. What is your overall feel, though, on this RNC?
It's Trump all the way. I mean, I've been to almost all these events with, half of our crew, and you see thousands upon thousands of people that come from Canada, that come from states away to go listen to this man speak. No one does that for Hillary Clinton. There was like 100 people that showed up to Long Beach to her event. It was lackluster. It was depressing. It was ridiculous. No one cares. She's horrible. Hillary for prison, 2016. Clinton for San Quentin.
What's it like to see our memes dominating everywhere?
It's everywhere. You can't walk 10 feet in Cleveland right now without seeing a Hillary for prison T-shirt. And if it's not ours, it's a knockoff. But hey, you guys are taking from us, and that's flattering. That's awesome.
Yeah, no. I mean, and to be quite frank, I saw one guy a year and a half ago with a sticker. I think it was like homemade. That's where I got the idea. I said, hey, some guy had a sticker. Let's put this out. And other people picked it up. I could care less. So I'm not even the progenitor of that idea. The point is, I'm just carrying the ball. just to get it out to folks. And so it's very, very exciting. If we're going to make a run at Hillary Clinton, let's go all the way. What do you make of Milo? Lifetime ban. This is their model of the internet, where they claim he incited cultural or sexual or racist stuff because he said the new Ghostbusters movie looks so horrible. In the trailer, I would never watch it. Not because it's three women. They suck, man.
I was bullhorning all the different Twitter stations that are set up throughout the RNC screaming free Milo, and then had the entire crowd chanting. And we were all sitting there giving them thumbs down. Milo's over there laughing. I mean, we were sitting there booing him and doing all that. And we're like, free Milo, shame on you. You guys are dirtbags. Freedom of speech. And everyone was just like, yeah.
Oh, well, great job. We're going to go down Media Road later. We're going to go out and set out of commies later. They're looking for us.
Oh, yes.
Oh, yeah. And then we're going to also go in for Trump's speech tonight. Good job, Vic.
Roger that.
Milo Yiannopoulos, with tens of millions of Twitter followers, just viral videos every day. I don't really need to introduce who he is. Successful entrepreneur. And he also goes by the dangerous faggot because I guess he doesn't want to go along with the fake liberals that want to restrict free speech and like ban the word mother and father and all this weird Jim Jones stuff. But I mean, I didn't realize how huge this interview was going to be because I've been trying to get you on for months. And then, I met you over at the Ritz at one of those Republican functions covering stuff. And I know you and Paul Watson have talked, and he's been covering how you get censored all over the internet. But they're now using you. Literally, I can't believe this is happening. While this coup against the media happens, Fox News has a coup taking it over. Drudge has warned everybody that the Supreme Court justice told him now is the time they're coming after free speech. He warned a year ago. It's now happening on this show. And I think this interview is up there in importance because this is the day after you've been banned, lifetime ban. And they say under these UN rules, anybody will be banned on the internet, period, if you've been shown to be hateful, for making fun of the abominable Ghostbusters movie. So this is getting crazier and crazier. And I wondered, I'm like, Milo's not giving statements to the press. They're all, it's like one of the top stories in the world right now. I mean, this is crazy. And he comes in and goes, oh yeah, I'm going to give you the unfettered statement because it's live and I won't be censored. So Milo, you've got the floor. Walk through what's happened. A lot of folks are watching. A lot of people are listening. We'll recap it to a little bit later, but thanks for coming in.
Thank you so much. Thank you for having me. I'm glad we got to do this at last.
You bet. Well, this is insane. This is wild. I didn't realize, I mean, I knew this was epic, but I didn't realize it was like supernova epic.
Turn me into the little star of the RNC. I don't know how stupid Twitter is, but I don't think they anticipated what was going to happen.
Well, let's talk about, for new viewers or folks that haven't followed it, what's really happened. Your statement, go ahead.
Sure. Well, I published a review of the new Ghostbusters movie, which is a really bad film. It's a very bad film. It seems to me to be the first film, I mean, maybe the first film I've ever seen, anyone I can think of, which has been conceived entirely out of spite. This is a movie that just hates men. It is a movie that can, that drops in a million little dull, thin, mean, nasty, third-wave, Twitter-style feminist jabs. They throw Bill Murray out of the window. It's a sort of nice metaphor for what they've done to the franchise generally. And at the end, they shoot the big marshmallow guy in the nuts, to kill. It's just all these tiny, nasty little jabs.
Sounds like
throughout.
Toddlers made a movie.
Exactly, exactly. It's the first movie I can think of that was made entirely out of childish spite. Now, the thing about the first Ghostbusters movie, and maybe people didn't think of this at the time, but it is like a libertarian showcase. The bad guys in the first movie aren't the ghosts. The bad guys in the first movie are the government. The ghosts in the first movie are adorable. They're nice, fun characters.
Slimer looks like a good guy to party with.
Of course. Who doesn't want to party with the ghosts from Ghostbusters? No, but the villains in the first movie were the government. It was the bungling bureaucrats getting in the way of
the
private
EPA.
Exactly. Well, yeah, getting in the way of private
enterprise.
Yes, it's
true. This man has no dick. I'm sorry.
It's, anyway, the new movie is entirely from this sort of mean, I know you do a lot of feminism. Paul Joseph Watson does a lot of feminism.
I've seen it, though. A lot of movies now, you go see them. The new House Party movie was unwatchable, all about how men are demons. We did all this stuff, and I was just like, I wasn't even offended. It was so horrible.
Yeah.
I was like assaulted. If you're going to assault me, at least make it entertaining.
Do you know what? I have a golden rule in life, which is be twice as funny as you are offensive, and this failed my golden rule. I wouldn't have minded if I'd been laughing along, but it was almost worse than a genuinely kind of terrible movie. It was just sort of, you kind of like chuckled a few times, but otherwise it was just dreadful. Anyway, I published a review on Breitbart, a 2,000-word review. It's very long, very funny.
Breitbart.com. Give folks the
Well, if you want to see, yeah, if you want to see stuff by and about me now, no longer on Twitter, but you can go to Breitbart.com/Milo, and they aggregate everything about me in one place.
For now.
I'm not going to get banned from Breitbart anytime soon, I don't think.
But they are going after the internet, is what I mean.
No, of course. So, you know, you can go there. Anyway, I published this 2,000-word review, and Leslie Jones, who is the Black Ghostbuster, didn't like it very much. She wasn't very keen on it. She took to Twitter to say
She was triggered.
She took to Twitter to say, you know, you're terrible, you should be banned, all the rest of it. So I cracked a few jokes, as I am wont to do sometimes. You know, she blocked me, so I took a screenshot of that, and I said, ugh, rejected by another black dude, because she looks remarkably like one of my ex-boyfriends. You know, a few little jokes like that, you know. I mean, just little things like I do all the time. I mean, look, if you don't like that kind of humor, fine. But, you know, remarkably, I think Twitter's finally pulled the trigger. On me. They've had a Milo problem for a while. They've been
lifetime ban.
With a lifetime ban on Twitter because I made a few jokes about, you know, this is the state.
But you use your fame, your personality to drive tens of millions of followers there, and then they just take it from you. We are the people that make Twitter and Facebook big. I just don't get this.
Well, we're the most interesting thing on there. I mean, the left is so boring now. All they do is sort of hector and language police, and you know, they look at the world through one prism alone, which is the prism of bigotry. Is this person racist, sexist, homophobic, or transphobic? If not, we're not interested in the story, and if yes, go nuts. You know, that's really all most of the American media does now. They have given up the pursuit of truth and exposing wrongdoing, and instead they're in the business of virtue signaling to each other.
Well, you're taking this pretty good, but I mean, for me, it's a bellwether with the coup at Fox, all the stuff
well,
that's
you're
going on.
You're going, you're next. They're coming for you next.
Oh, believe me, they're already after me.
You and Coulter, they're going to get all of us. For me, very honestly, I'm not as upset as people think I should be about this because, you know, it's turned me into a little micro star on this. You know, I've become a free speech martyr. Thing is, you know, I saw this coming, so I've started to plan. I don't have anything like the audience you do, but I'm starting to build one on YouTube and various other places.
Well, he's got a huge audience, but yeah. probably, but expanding on that, then let's talk about what they're claiming you did, because Paul Watson shot a video about it. I saw
you
break it down.
It's interesting that no one will publish it. You know, all these left-wing media outlets, you know, who I've said no to interviews to because I wanted to sit down with somebody who was kind of on message, I can actually talk, you know. All these media outlets said, oh, Milo Yiannopoulos incited this hate brigade and these terrible things. Not one of them quotes anything I said.
I was reading the New York Times. It sounded like you'd, like, committed murders or something.
No, not one of them.
All you was make fun.
Anything I said. And, of course, you know, I'm like... So what Twitter's line on this seems to be that I incited harassment of an individual by publishing a movie review? Are you insane? Should I start censoring my movie reviews in case they contain any women or black characters that might get bad words on the internet? This is nuts.
Yeah, so you cover it. A few trolls, might even be them, say something racist. Now it's your fault.
Is it?
So it's like the Nazis. If somebody fought them in Poland, down the street, they'd kill the whole street.
No, I mean, seriously.
So like, you know, like if your neighbor does something wrong, we're going to come after you.
Exactly. This guilt by association, a classic tactic.
Fascist.
Classic tactic of the left, classic authoritarian tactics, you know, guilt by association. It's the Zelensky stuff, which you know very well.
You're right, the left and the right have done it, but I mean, this is classic totalitarianism.
They know it, of course.
Someone, you wrote an article, so people in the comments made racist comments, you're banned.
Yeah. Yeah, and you know, the thing is, you know, they don't go after, you know, in fact, Twitter employees have been egging on the war between, like, for instance, Taylor Swift and Kim Kardashian, you know, these sort of celebrity wars. They love
That's okay.
They love to egg
on. You can have Twitter accounts say kill Donald Trump.
Of course, and you know, female...
But you can't make fun of a bad movie.
Female, conservative women get it even worse than we do. I mean, if you've ever talked to Ann Coulter about this...
Do you know what Leanne McAdoo goes through on Twitter?
No, I don't even want to know.
It is horrible.
I dread to think.
And it's all the left doing it.
I have never, you know, my day job is technology editor at Breitbart, you know, so it's my job to keep an eye on this kind of stuff. I don't think I can ever remember an example of a progressive being banned from Twitter, no matter whether it was a rape threat, a death threat, nothing.
They have Facebook ones too.
I don't think I've ever seen an example.
Saying kill Trump.
Yeah, I don't think I've ever seen an example of one of these people be banned. It's so astonishing. You know,
Why do you think they're so scared of you? Because they really do hate you.
Oh, because they can't beat me. Because I fall into this weird sort of, well, for the left anyway, a weird character, this gay conservative who's like sassy and funny and interesting, and they can't do what they normally do with like the straight white men, call them bigots and misogynists and all the rest of it. They can't label me like they normally do. They can't call me names. None of the traditional leftist tactics work on me because they're obviously just in it. You know, it's obviously not true. You can't call me a homophobe and get away with it. It's so stupid, you know? So they can't beat me in debate. When they come to my university talks, all they can do is shout me down, try to censor me, try to have me banned. So this is the last option they have available to them. They can't win in the court of public opinion. They can't win with ideas. So they just shut you down instead.
Well, obviously they would spin what you said. They won't show your actual statements. So I'm going to skip this network break. I want you to take over, Milo, because I want you to host a show right now.
I will do so.
You're not being censored. And I want you to tell folks that are watching what you really stand for, what you really said about Ghostbusters.
Perfect.
And because you got the floor. Go ahead.
Wonderful. Ghostbusters is a really bad movie, but worse than the movie is what feminism has done to its stars, to the women who act in this movie. It's turned the superstars of Hollywood blockbusters into victims. Nothing offends me, really. I mean, I don't have that bit of my brain where I get offended or afraid or all the rest of it. I may be unbroken, but I don't get offended by many things. But I was sort of offended on behalf of women, not just because of the stereotypical and dumb portrayals of women in this movie. You know, you've got the tomboy, you've got the sort of 80s sassy black woman played by Leslie Jones, which all my black friends cringed at enormously. But what happened to these women is they turned themselves into professional victims, into grievance mongers, and these are strong, talented, successful women who are sitting at home in wherever they live in, you know, Beverly Hills or whatever, on their iPhones, worrying about what people are saying on the internet. These women are victims, but not
poor babies.
I know, but these women are victims, just not of what they think. They're not victims of the patriarchy. They're not victims of some white supremacist conspiracy. These people are victims of feminism. These women are victims of people who have told them that everything that is wrong in their life is down to a man somewhere, or black people, that everything is wrong in your life is down to some sort of hegemonic capitalist hetero patriarchal system. It simply isn't true, and it's so shocking to me and so depressing to see women who do now have access to, you know, education, to all the institutions of civil society, to government, everything else, constantly told that they are victims, that they are oppressed, that everything that bad happens to them in their life is somebody else's fault. And Leslie Jones, I don't know whether she was deployed by the studio on purpose to kind of drum up some sympathy because the
movie obviously was bombing. This is all staged.
I mean, it seems that way.
So, like, make money off killing the First Amendment. Boycott their damn film.
It seems that way to me. And, of course, you've got to bear in mind Sony and Amy Pascal at Sony. She was caught saying some slightly off-color things about Barack Obama in those emails that were leaked from Sony. Yeah. You remember, let's take him to go see Django or whatever it was. You know, and if she was like, So this is Amy Pascal trying to get her social justice credentials back. This is there's a lot of things going on here. And I just, from my point of view, I talk a lot about feminism in my college talks. I'm so shocked and saddened by what the left and what feminism and what political correctness has done to women. Women have been reporting themselves as getting progressively less happy every decade since the Second World War. It cannot be unrelated.
That's right. It's a bunch. Let's just say it. And I'm not being mean about this. But it's a bunch of weird, twisted, ugly women.
It is.
That are jealous.
And mainly lesbians, by the way.
Exactly.
It is.
No, it is. And they want the women. And I get it. I want women, too. They want to keep them on this reservation.
No, but it's like, of course these feminists hate men. They're all lesbians. If you look, I say this in my talks, and people get offended by this.
It's competition.
No, exactly. You look at the academic roster. You know, you look at the faculty list in a gender studies department.
Yeah, they want to bring girls in, brainwash them.
Divorce, dyke. And we're letting these women lecture, like, other women on how to negotiate with men. It's like putting Hitler in charge of a museum of Jewish antiquity. Why are these angry, overweight, horrendous, like, chip on shoulder conspiracy theory, you know, indulging lesbianic monsters telling women how to be women? That's insane.
Exactly. This is actually a group of vampiric pig goblins trying to destroy femininity.
I knew this was going to get competitive.
This is a satanic demon trying to sup on the essence of the goddess.
Well, I can't beat that
one. It's an attempt at murder of the goddess. Damn you, Janet Reno.
No, you know what? People get offended by this,
women, and I'm telling you, Hillary Clinton and Janet Reno aren't one.
Well,
they're not even men.
Well, you know, there's, you know what?
But you're a man. You know, the average man's just wanting to live their life and bumbling around. I mean,
men just want food, sex, and sleep. You know, we're very simple creatures, and when we want sex really badly, we have our testosterone kicks in, and we do competitive things. You know, we build civilization, we go to the moon, we build the internet. You know, patriarchy ain't that fucking bad. You know, like, it's
patriarchy
not that bad.
Rules, you know, white male privilege.
No, if there is a patriarchy, women should be thankful for it, because, you know, they are the beneficiaries. It's women who take more out of the tax system while putting less in. It is women who benefit from male inventions.
It's true. I put the women up a little pink pillow.
Of course, but that's exactly how we should treat women. We should treat them with chivalry and respect. You know, we should honor and obey women. But the problem, the problem is that feminists take advantage of that. They like to prey on a man's natural instinct for chivalry.
They've been bullying us.
Exactly. Well, I mean, you know, I don't throw that word around too lightly, but it is kind of true.
It's kind of true.
And these women prey on a man's natural chivalrous instinct. Like, when they play the victim, they say, "Oh, I'm at home crying," and they know that male journalists are going to try to run to their defense. They're going to white knight them. You know, that is the worst kind of sociopathy and opportunism and ugly behavior, and it all it does is drive the sexes apart. And you know, if you want a sort of compassionate point here, That hurts women most, because men in their 30s can retreat into porn and video games and their buddies and sports and working out. They're generally okay.
You're right. No, statistics show men are retreating from women.
Right. And I wrote a piece about this, I think, 2 years ago called The Sex Addict on Breitbart. And you've covered this a lot. And I know Paul Joseph Watson's covered this a lot. This is a real thing. Men are kind of retreating out of society, sort of giving up on dating women because it's just too much hassle.
It's like, you hate me, you're making stuff up. Fine, I'm out.
Fine, I'm out. We know women, on the other hand, in their 30s, if they're still single, you know, getting to the late 30s, they're very, very unhappy. Men kind of deal with it better. It's just another way
to take the average feminist that's all whacked out and freaked out and deprogram them in like 2 weeks, and they're like, oh my God, I'm alive. This is
Well, you probably do this in real life. I do this with people in my college talks, right? There's women in the audience who come, and they come to cause trouble, and then they queue up at the end for a photo and said, my life has just been changed. I had no idea. And I'm like,
it's a psychological warfare brainwashing template, taking real issues that were going on in the past, projecting them onto things now, just because a bunch of women who like women want their own stable of women. And instead, they're actually putting them into their own brainwashing camp, and they're actually oppressing them.
The real victims here are these young, vulnerable, impressionable girls who arrive at university and they meet these body positivity supporting professors who say it's fine to be fat, it's fine, you're healthy at any size. That's a lie. These people are lying to vulnerable, impressionable young girls of 17, 18, 19 years old.
Well, they're really meeting is their man. So their 400-pound man meets them, they take them into a brainwashing camp, and freak them all out, get them all freaked out, and then tell them, we're going to free you. You know, little girls' camps. I've got 2 daughters. I've got to watch out what camp you send them to. Don't just say some sports or art camp. Mm-hmm. You get there, and it's literally men are out to get you. We're going to teach you your new identity.
Of course.
That's like, I don't tell my daughters either. They're going to learn that. You're not their parent. I mean, these people are telling my kids stuff I found out that I haven't told them yet.
Yeah.
I mean, that's crazy.
But this is a sort of social authoritarianism of the left. They want the state, and they want these lobbies and charities and feminists to step into the role of parent. Because, of course, this is the ultimate, it's the Ghostbusters movie, right? In the first movie, libertarian, private enterprise, they eventually conquer the tyrannous government. You know what happens at the end of the new Ghostbusters?
No.
They end up on the government payroll. The Ghostbusters, the female Ghostbusters, end up being paid by the state.
Look at the woman under Hitler. Yeah. He said, first you get the women, and you get the all the men. Women under a fascist totalitarian state, they marry the state.
Exactly. And this is precisely, I mean, is there a better analogy for modern feminism than the thin, mean, pathetic bobs and inefficacy and nastiness?
And notice, they even got chicks that didn't look good.
They're so ugly.
And you know, trying to force
they're
me this,
so it's ugly.
I haven't followed it.
Yeah. I mean, I think it took $44 million in its opening weekend, and this is a $150 million film. They probably spent another $150 on marketing. This is a huge failure.
So the good news is it's blowing up in their face.
And Sony, because they are so desperate to be politically correct, this is the real good news, have committed to a sequel already, but just because those nasty misogynists on the internet. So they're committed to a sequel. They're going to burn even more money. It's great.
So they could potentially bankrupt. The cult by just
keep calling it like it is. This is a bad movie conceived out of spite. But my jaw dropped at the end of that movie because the mayor's number two shows up to see the Ghostbusters, says thanks for all you've done, we're going to take you in now, anything you need, come to us. They end up civil servants, they end up a government department. Is there a better analogy for feminism than that? I don't think so.
Well, the government's taking over femininity. And it's going to be managed by a bunch of women that aren't women.
Yes.
By the way, I'm not bashing women that like women. I totally get it. And there's a lot of great women out there that happen to be lesbians that I know are great patriots. I'm just saying it's particular leftist, communist, weirdo women that
want to. But you know there's science on this. And every once in a while, they'll give you a gift. And Lindy West, who is a very stupid and fat person, who wrote a column, I think, for Jezebel a few years ago. And she is both of those things, I'm sorry. She wrote a column for Jezebel when she said, and she explained what this is all about. She said, women who don't conform to traditional beauty stereotypes are more likely to end up left-wing. Why? Because they find a sort of alternative culture that will accept them. And then they find this sort of weird pathological culture that says that being ugly and alternative is great and you should get as fat as you want, darling, and your self-esteem shouldn't, you know, rest on a man's opinion of you. Well, if you want a husband, maybe it should.
Well, all I know is it's like there's a war on just people have always done different stuff, but it just seems like it's all these people that follow different lifestyles, and then they're pissed that other people are happy. And so all I say is, as long as
they want us to be as miserable as they are. That's what social justice is about. It's a sort of extended form of self-hurt, you know? It's a sort of self-harm extended out into the 30s, you know? All they want to do is hurt themselves and hurt people.
That's like the big thing in feminism is, too, like, harming themselves and...
Well, they're hurting other women. You know, in the 90s when we grew up, I had Marilyn Manson, I had Nirvana, I had, you know, all these... You know, there was the emo culture. I mean, I didn't cut myself, obviously, but plenty of my friends did. And, you know, we got it out of our systems. Social justice kids, they're growing up on, like, Selena Gomez and Justin Bieber. They don't get it out of their systems. So they get into their 30s and they're still angry and it's got to go somewhere, and it turns, in my view, into social justice. Social justice is a kind of protracted, like, self-loathing, I think.
We're going to go to break in a moment, and I would imagine listeners might want to obviously talk to you. The toll-free number, if you want to talk to Milo,
sure,
with a specific quick question, is 800-259-9231, 800-259-9231. In fact, the press was unable to talk to him. You can call in if you're members of the press.
I've got to tell you very quickly. We turned the Daily Show away from our Gays for Trump party. So they showed up and they wanted to do their typical slice and dice to make people look stupid. So we trained a camera on them, and we're going to, like, well, we'll have your footage and our footage, and viewers can decide whether you gave a fair
reaction.
So they ran away. They ran away. So Daily Show, if you're watching and you'd like to actually ask a real question, get a real answer, feel free to call in.
Exactly, because when you take the field against these totalitarians, they crumble.
Of course.
They can only win, like, when
playground
nobody opposes
bullies.
Them.
They're playground bullies.
800-259-9231. Milo, obviously people go to Breitbart.com.
They
can read your stories there. They can read your evil review of the Ghostbusters that got banned. Where else can they follow you?
You can follow me on YouTube. I'm not difficult to track down there. I'm going to open a Snapchat account. This is my revenge on Twitter, is I'm going to Snapchat, which is, it's probably better for me anyway, because a lot of my fans are so young.
But what is, it shows how they are disconnected. They've only taken you from being a star to a superstar by banning you and saying lifetime ban.
They don't understand the Streisand effect at all. They just don't get it. They don't understand that by letting me get on with it, they are causing less harm to their own cause than making me a sort of martyr.
Well, Twitter is only going to endanger itself, because I've seen Digg and other places years ago that did censorship go from big to small.
And they all crumble. Once you start, you know, it's a private company. You can't demand that they adhere to the First Amendment, but you can remind them, and I will be reminding them over the next 6 months, that adhering to First Amendment principles is simply good business, because any social networks that don't do that end up crumbling.
Just like our comment page, people go crazy on
that. Yeah, I love it. Well, Breitbart's the same. You know, it's like Free Speech Central over there, and sometimes it's ugly, and sometimes it's brilliant. And that's
all
the glory
of
the internet.
Newspapers are crumbling. And they're even getting rid of comment sites.
Yeah.
They don't get, people only come there to comment, dumbass.
They don't want to read the lies you're telling them. They want to have a debate with somebody.
Yeah, they don't seem to get that.
No, they don't. But that's great. It's more business for
people
us.
People 10 years ago would say, why don't people come in here and attack you? I'm like, it's all made up crap anyway.
I don't know who gives a shit.
Yeah. It's like, me and McAdoo are married and all this crud. I only wish. No, seriously, this is so ridiculous. All right, Milo's here. Well, it's good to have you on air. We've tried to get you on air, so I'm glad to have you here in a big way, folks. Get this link out, Infowars.com/show or stations you're listening to. This is a political thought criminal. Don't worry, we don't defend him. You're next. Stay with us. Ladies and gentlemen, we are back live with the thought criminal, Milo Yiannopoulos. And, of course, he's also on Facebook for now. Facebook's smarter. They've just been banning smaller folks, blocking memes we put out that go viral. Some memes going super viral with 10 million, you know, shares, they'll block it. But they understand they still want us on Facebook, not Twitter. Twitter does seem to be one of the most servile to the establishment. Has that been your findings?
Oh, for sure. I mean, look, there are worries about Facebook. Facebook, for instance, is in league with the German government to criticize, you know, perfectly respectable concerns people have about immigration there. But Twitter's the one that's really, you know, hand in hand with, you know, nannying, mollycoddling, you know, government officials. And also, of course, the worst set of social justice warriors, that whole Silicon Valley, you know, California nonsense, you know.
Where do you see this? Because you're a smart guy. I mean, I really actually want to hear, it's not just a question, where you think it's going. How does this evolve? This huge clampdown on speech, this trying to brainwash the kids in school. I mean, it's so over the top. I read this stuff and I can't believe they're actually doing it. It's like comical. In fact, I laugh a lot of times. Like 5 years ago, Seattle is banning brown paper bags because they could be seen as racist. And they went on and said, there's never been anyone claim a brown paper bag is connected to something racist. We're just banning it. So we see all this going on. I mean, I know it's social control, but then you actually talk to these so-called liberals. They're like mental patients. Mm-hmm. What's going on?
Well, I should largely share your analysis of why it's happened, but I might have a slightly more optimistic prognosis than you do. I sort of think that this, it's obvious from the success of Donald Trump, who we both like. It's obvious from Brexit. It's obvious from how popular people like us are, that there is a gigantic sort of popular rebellion, a revolt among people who don't necessarily hugely concern themselves
those
with
those people that are
politics.
Out there.
Well, then it's you people.
Right.
You know, there's a huge popular revolt among people who are tired of being told they're sexist when they know they're not. Tired of being told they're racist when they know they're not. Tired of being labeled as bigots when they have perfectly respectable, reasonable opinions that millions of people share. I think we've reached a sort of breaking point where the left has overreached itself. It's taken too much for granted. It started, you know, in its sort of puritanism, has started trying to control too many little minutiae of everyday life. And people are at breaking point. And I think the Trump phenomenon is an example of that. So I'm relatively optimistic about the future.
What has your political level? I mean, tell us about yourself. A lot of folks obviously know who you are and read your writings and things and see your videos. But I mean, what was your evolution when you like brought up libertarian, conservative, liberal? I mean, what was it like? I mean, for me, it's just watching the so-called left grandstand and project onto clouds in the sky how they've been wrong. It really seems like a drama queen pity party.
It's gay. That's what it is. It's gay. I want to restore this word, by the way. I want to give everybody I do an interview with, I want to give them a lifetime retroactive fag pass so they can use words like gay in the way they're supposed to be used. I mean, rubbish, lame, Hillary supporting, immigrant loving, you know, all of this. That's the proper use of gay. That's how I want to. This stuff is, you know what it was, I kind of grew up and I remember an element of choice in my sexuality, but I would never have gone with the gay thing if I'd known how awful other gay people were going to be. And I grew up watching this sort of victimhood and grievance and sort of, oh, we're so oppressed. And I didn't relate to that at all. I thought, what is wrong with you people? My experience of it was I was endlessly mollycoddled and pandered to and celebrated. You know, the media loves that. You know, there are so many talentless people who are in very influential
positions. It's horrible at the bars and the brand new BMWs and the jobs.
Yeah, isn't it just awful? I mean, you've got nothing going for you whatsoever except your sexuality, and you're on television, and, you know, readers will have their own ideas about who I'm talking about. But, you know, I just never related to any of that. And then when I started working as a journalist, I sort of saw the media and political correctness, of course, now in America has become deadly with San Bernardino, Orlando. People knew about these guys and didn't report them for fear of being Islamophobic or
racist.
It's
like the Russian, the German minister that got raped by Muslims.
And lied about it because you didn't want to stoke Islamophobia. It's so insane. It's so insane. In Sweden now, where you're not allowed to report the ethnicity and religion of rape
attackers. In Finland, this guy got attacked by guys with guns and baseball bats. He fought back. So he's getting a 4-year sentence, and they're getting like 3 months.
Oh, my goodness. Anyway.
They said that for the crime of too vigorous self-defense.
I mean, I grew up, ashamed of being identified with this group of, like, hectoring, nannying, awful gays. You know, I call them the bad gays. And I just realized that my, you know, calling was resisting this kind of political correctness. So I've become a kind of warrior for free speech and for the First Amendment. And that's why I love America, because it is
still... Well, sure, gay people, like, say, back in Greece or in Rome or wherever, like, manly and stuff. Where did this come from, like, this...
The sissy stuff?
Yeah.
I don't know. I mean, I think, you know, I like to have fun with it, and I like to kind of dress in silly clothes.
Sure.
It antagonizes the left, right?
Sure, I understand that's why they hate it. But I mean, fine. Yeah. I'm saying, when did that become?
But the sissy stuff, you know, it's very interesting to me that, you know, gay people are constantly celebrated as being unique and remarkable and all the rest of it. And they all look like each other. They sound like each other. They have terrible sets. I don't know where this meme occurred.
Because gay guys used to, like, conquer the world, like, burn cities.
No, it's Alexander the Great. And yeah, now what do we have? RuPaul's Drag Race. I mean, I like that show because it's fun. But this is where gay culture and where gay people are so overrepresented in history, in, like, you know, artists, philosophers, politicians. What do we have now? You know, nothing. Gay culture is so boring and so bland. I never identify with any of this stuff. I want people to push the limits of what can be thought and said. I want people to break
the rules. So what's happened in the modern world then? Because it's not just, quote, gay people that are acting like a bunch of fops. You've got men, women. Did civilization make it too easy and we got soft?
Yes, I think so. I mean, Camille Paglia, who you will know and I'm sure quite like, you know, says that the trans thing always pops up just before the fall of a great civilization.
It does. It's a cycle.
You know? Yeah. And it's a sort of late decadent period in an empire's trajectory, you know? I pretty much think that's spot on for what we're experiencing in America. I think Europe is basically lost. I like to think that America could be saved, though. And I'd like to think that there is some hope for America and that there's a possibility that we can reaffirm and and return to the primal importance of the principle of the First and Second Amendments, the basis on which this country is founded, what made it the best country in the world, and just remind everybody what happens when you don't have those things. Look at the Middle East, look at Africa, look at the countries where you don't have freedom of expression.
Absolutely.
Freedom of thought.
And by the way, I'm going low tech here today, being very lazy. I have my computer over here and I can punch up callers, but I haven't done that on the Comrex. Will you guys, I open the phones up, will you send me the calls on my iPhone so I can go to them? I am again here on the road at the RNC 2016. Milo is here with us, a ton of energy and making a lot of really great points. So I'm glad this interview happened. I'm really glad that I came to the RNC. I almost want to go to the DNC now. But I got to tell you,
I'm going to get killed in Sweden instead. Do you know that?
Do what?
I'm going to get killed in Sweden instead. Do you know that?
No.
No, I'm going to lead a gay pride march through a Muslim ghetto in Stockholm next week.
I heard you.
Instead
of going
to Philly.
Yeah. I hope you, wow. They're probably trying to arrest you for religious incitement saying,
oh, probably.
How dare you have your rights.
Yeah, probably. So I'm glad I did this. It might be the last interview I give.
Wow. I got to tell you, you got some huevos because Biggs and them aren't wimps. And they went over to Molenbeek there in Brussels, Belgium, man. It was like, no go.
It's bad.
Like, you're not getting gas here. You're not eating here. Get out.
Yeah.
People chasing them, screaming at them.
Yeah.
So, and you're going, I forgot you're doing that too. Tell us what else you're up to.
Over summer, I'm going to be spending some time back in London for a change in August. And then in September, my Dangerous Faggot Tour starts again, the college tour where I've been.
Explain that. Yeah, talk about that. Because I mean, a lot of folks have heard about it or they've seen clips, but you just try to go speak at colleges and they try to stop you.
Mm-hmm.
Because they're so liberal.
Well, because they can't cope with the idea that a gay man might have opinions that go off reservation. You know, the left has persuaded people for so long.
So you're saying you're not in a cult?
Right, I'm not in a cult. You know, I like to think of myself as a free thinker, as an iconoclast, you know, and I just like to talk about free speech and why it matters. And this is such an offense to the left. It is so distasteful to the left that they send people down, they pay protesters to come down and, like, you know, leap on stage, swing for me, snatch the mic. It's remarkable. It's remarkable. Black Lives Matter and DePaul, you know, charged the stage, wouldn't let the event continue. So we let a march on the principal's office instead.
What does your gut tell you? I mean, we've seen Michael Moore come out on Politically Incorrect last night and say, look, I think Trump's going to win. I think he is, too, because most people are closeted and they're afraid to admit they're for Trump. I mean, I think unless there's huge election fraud, I think Trump wins in a landslide.
I have a feeling it's either going to be a narrow victory or a big defeat. I'm not sure about the landslide, but I will. You know about preference falsification. Of course you do.
Yes.
I very much believe that is happening in America right now. You know, it's kind of the BuzzFeed thing. Everyone sort of says they read BuzzFeed and everyone sort of says they're a feminist because it's easy because the social pressures all move in that direction. It, you know, just for quiet life, you'll kind of agree with certain things you don't really agree with. I think Trump is an example of this, and I think we're going to see what's called a preference cascade, you know, when people just suddenly realize there's no social consequences attached to telling the truth, voting how you really want to vote, and you realize that loads of your friends are doing it too. That's happening right now in America. People are sort of having
That's why I'm thinking you're going to have a landslide.
Right. Well, people have it. I mean, maybe you're right. People are having these furtive conversations with each other about, are you voting for? Yeah, I am. And this is happening right now in America, all over the country. And the pollster, you know, people lie to pollsters about this stuff all the time because they don't.
I've had Hispanic guys that are doing my yard come over and say, I like your show. Your brother's speaking English. I like Trump.
Yeah.
And I say, why? And he goes, he wants to, you know, make money for family.
It's true, but you know, you go to Los Angeles.
Taxes, you know. Oh yeah, genius.
Everyone tells you that, you know, these in Los Angeles, like, you know, everyone's up in arms about Trump. I go to Los Angeles all the time because we're based there, and everybody I meet is voting for Trump. You know, we went into a camera store to pick up a lens the other day, and the guy behind the counter is Hispanic, and he saw a little pin or something on me, and he's like, "Yeah, mugger." You know, like all the time.
It's also a rebellion thing. It's like, look, forget even who Trump is. We're sick of the Bushes, we're sick of the Obamas, we're sick of the Clintons.
Right. Well, it's that sort of tired globalist establishment order, you know, sort of the business as usual candidates. People want to see them burn. They want to hurt them, you know?
What happens to Trump, though, if he doesn't try to deliver? Man, he is. If he gets in office and doesn't try to deliver, wow. I'm coming after him.
I mean, I kind of want him to build the wall, fix trade, smash political correctness, and then do nothing else. You know, I don't want him to do anything else. I want him to be like Coolidge. I want him to be basically a president who just sits there and quietly administers.
You're going to play golf.
We don't need any more activist presidents.
Just take the foot off America's neck.
Right. Why do we need more government departments, more federal government spending, more, like, you know, we don't need activist presidents anymore. We've had enough of those, I think. You know, you have had enough of those.
I want to go to calls here in a moment, but in 60 seconds, addressing the camera right there, Milo, what is the 60-second boil down of where this country is?
America is And I don't say this lightly, and I know people say this every election, but America really has a huge decision that's going to determine the future of the country, because the next president is going to get to appoint a huge number of Supreme Court justices. It cannot be Hillary Clinton. Men will be under attack. You know, even white people will be under attack, based on what some of Hillary Clinton's friends like to say. Donald Trump represents, to me, the most exciting thing that's happened in politics in America in the last 30 years, and that is an existential threat to political correctness. It is the best thing that's happened to America, and is the most important thing you can possibly do if you love the Constitution and you appreciate the principles on which America was founded, is vote for Trump.
It's a no-brainer. The entire filthy power structure is against him. I mean, how could you not be for Trump?
Look at the people who hate him. That tells me more than enough. You know, everyone who hates him the most, they're the worst people in the world, and that's good enough for me.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, Milo, you know, I've talked to you in private. You're calm, subdued, gentlemanly guy, and I've always seen your clips on TV. You're very animated. But I tell you, you got a lot of energy, man, and your points are all really cogent.
High energy, as we like to say.
Absolutely. I'm going to take some phone calls here for folks for Milo. But again, since you're being censored, don't take for granted Infowars.com. Don't take for granted DrudgeReport.com. Don't take for granted what Milo's been doing. They're coming after all of us, as Drudge almost a year ago came in the studio to warn everybody in that exclusive interview. So Milo, give people the different contact points for you.
You can find me on Facebook. Just search for my name. You'll see the little verified check. Amazingly, Facebook hasn't taken that away yet. They do seem to be a little better. I think you're right about that. You can find me on YouTube, and you can find all the stuff by and about me, all the journalist stuff, clips from media appearances, and all sorts of things at Breitbart.com/Milo.
Well, I haven't heard anything where anybody needs to be banned or arrested.
No, I don't think I've said anything that makes me a danger to the state yet.
I mean, and it's true that Janet Reno looked like a... like the Stay Puft Marshmallow.
I mean, what kind of a world do we live in when we can't call an ugly person ugly? I mean, please, if someone's ugly, they're ugly.
Hey,
you know?
I'm ugly compared to what I looked like 20 years ago.
I don't know.
I'm only going to get uglier, so let people say it.
You're doing okay for your age, actually.
Well, people call me names all over the internet. I think it's funny. Since when can people not take something, you know?
No, of course. I mean, you know, not being able to take a joke. You know what the worst of it is? The worst of it is they're allowed to come at you with all of the vitriol that they can muster, all of the spitefulness and hatefulness they can muster. But somebody on the political right or a libertarian cracks a joke, and they sort of disingenuously pretend that it was some kind of hate attack. And it's like, no, I was just making fun of you. And making fun of you is okay.
There was a video like 6 months ago or 5 months ago. Biggs was out at this Oregon University where they banned the Trump people. Mm-hmm. You'd be able to have their own event. And they were, by the way, Hispanic.
Yeah.
They've been banned. And Biggs, those were wearing InfoWars shirts. And literally, these even professors came in and they saw them. They go, InfoWars, I'm scared. And they go, please. And they knew it was fake. But it was like, my God, these are like 2-year-olds.
I don't know why. It's this sort of feigned fear. I mean, like, I bet you, you're lovely. You're not, like, you know, it's like, in what way are you at risk from this stuff? They say when I go on college campuses, I'm a threat to their physical
Remember
safety.
Remember the chalking?
Are you kidding? Oh, no, chalking is a hate crime. You know, it's a threat to our quote-unquote.
Trump 2016.
Physical. Yeah, this is a race hate crime that is banned from DePaul. You know, and this represents a threat to physical safety of students. Get a grip. This is
Man,
ridiculous.
Man, this is like crazy. It's like living in a prison.
It's ridiculous.
Cindy.
Prison would be a lot more fun.
Cindy says she's a gay woman on feminism. Thanks for calling in, Cindy. You're on the air worldwide with Milo. Go ahead.
Hey, Milo, you're a real baby doll. You're real cute. Anyway, I'm a gay woman. Have been for 40 years. Mm-hmm. I despise feminism. I always have. Cheyenne, Clint Walker, that man always turned me on. I love men.
Okay, so you're not too gay. You like men, actually.
No. Yeah, I mean, I had a compliment. Some other men having compliments. How much of a lesbian are you really, madam?
No, the only difference is that I don't like
sex. She's double dipping.
I was viciously raped when I was young. And it kind of turned me off toward the sexual aspect of it.
Right.
But I'm very patriotic. I like chauvinist men. I love when men opening doors.
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah,
I know you think that's funny, but...
But how is that chauvinist? I was just told by my mother to do that.
No, I think she means chivalrous.
Chivalrous, yeah. Chivalrous. But that's what I mean. I was told to do that by my mother.
Of course, but...
So it's her fault.
But you know what it is? Feminism has been telling women for 30 years to treat women just like we treat each other. Well, taunting is how men bond. Let me tell you, women don't like it when men speak to them like they speak to each other. Men speak to each other horribly. They speak to women generally with respect and with consideration. You do not want that. Trust me, ladies.
When you start treating them like that.
I mean, women backstab each other and bitch about each other in private. Men just, like, roast each other in public, and women generally don't deal with that as well. Trust me, you don't want that.
Good points, man. Good to hear from you. Let's go ahead.
Thank you.
Got a lot of ladies calling today. Melissa in New York, you're on the air. Go ahead.
Hi. I just wanted to say, Milo, I'm a big fan of yours. And I have
Thank
to
you.
Say big fan because, yes, I am a fat girl.
Oh, no, that's okay. That's okay.
Sweetheart, there's nothing wrong. There's nothing wrong with being a little juicy. We're just saying we're going to make jokes about it.
Yes, which I think she's behind us.
But Milo, you know, has been writing articles lately about big girls, and I get flack for being a fan of his and being a big girl. But mm-hmm. I just have a question for you.
Of course.
You talk about being rich. And I was wondering if you had been talking to investors about maybe starting your own social media platform for people who are conservatives or for people who are free speech advocates when we have Twitter shadow banning people.
Well, thank you for the question. I'm not an entrepreneur, and I don't think I'd be very good at the head of a social networking company because I'd be too wild and too pro free speech. I'd like anything.
Hold on, we're going to skip this break. I hear music coming in. Go ahead.
Sure thing. You know, I think I'm not probably the right person to do it, but I'm very interested in hearing from people who are up to that. I know that a lot of people have emailed me saying they want to start an alternative to Twitter. A lot of people are saying, "What social networks are you going to?" Look, very simple for me. You know, Twitter sent a very big political statement. They didn't just block anyone; they blocked me, and it was a big political statement. It was the moment that Twitter said, if you like irreverence, mischief, fun, if you like people who take the mickey out of feminists, the mickey out of Black Lives Matter, if you like libertarians, if you like conservatives, if you like people who don't fit the mold, you're not welcome.
And if they can get away with shutting him down, they can shut us all down. Great to hear from him, Melissa. And let me say something about making fun of fat people. Listen, it's because they're trying to ban it, we have to do it. I gained 98 pounds over like 10, 15 years of not working out. I went from looking like a Calvin Klein model to looking like Jabba the Hutt. I do videos where I go, here I am as Jabba the Hutt. Here I am now, lost like 60-something pounds. I look better. I'm going to lose the rest. The whole point is we're not saying you're bad because you're fat. We're just saying we can't totally accept it. Only like we can't accept diabetes. We have to admit there's a problem. But I don't hate anybody because they're fat. I hate a leftist who's fat, though, who says we should ban free speech because they don't want their feelings hurt.
No,
at that point, I
want
to start talking about fat asses.
Of course. And, you know, this is an example of how the left creates the bigotry that it claims to be policing. It's a sort of Kafkaesque cycle where they create exactly what they say is out there in the world. The only reason I have a go at it is because people are sociopathically telling young girls that that the body positivity is okay, that you can be healthy at any size. That's simply a lie. And if the way to get the message over to people is to take the fun out of fatties, because, by the way, all the studies show fat shaming works, and all the sort of crazy liberal studies that are all horrible.
Yeah. Instead of like, hey, be proud, you go from 500 to 1,000 pounds.
Yep.
No, you need to go climb some hills.
No, exactly. There's nothing.
Look, I'm a fat ass. I haven't worked out since I've been here. When I get back, I'm on a 20-mile hike.
Right.
Already set up.
Of course. You know, and it's like, you know, the only reason that we do it is because we're provocateurs and we understand instinctively, both of us, and that's why I like you so much. We understand that free speech is meaningless if people are only saying what's so already socially acceptable. You know, you have to defend free speech at the limits of free speech. You have to defend offensive
Absolutely.
Speech. Otherwise, it means nothing.
Network, you guys didn't go to break, did you? Because I'm getting a... Okay, I'm just getting a little bit of a feed here. Good, we did skip the break. Good job. We're like, you know, they're like Houston. We're like up here on the moon right now, except it's Cleveland. After globalism, it kind of outside the city area kind of looks like the moon, but the people here are awesome.
The mistake on the lake. They call it the mistake on the lake. You
yeah,
know that?
That's an awesome place.
No, I like it.
Kissing their ass. The people here are great.
I like it.
Have you felt energy here?
Yes, I have. Yes, I have. And you know what's remarkable is I was told when I came to Republican National Convention, oh, there are going to be all these Christians. They're not going to like you. They're going to blank you. They're going to be frosty. I have had nothing but the warmest reception here. People walk up to me. They laugh me here. And, you know, that it's amazing when you look at the response from, you know, the Hillary Clinton sort of Saudi-funded leftist pandering to Islam people who treat
me. Yeah, if you went next week to Philadelphia, you would not be loved.
Can you imagine it? Can you imagine
it?
Yeah, no, exactly. And here, people come up to me with compassion. Passion and kindness and love, and I know that not all of your audience are into the Christian thing, but some of them will be.
True.
And you know, and all I can say is, you know, even the most socially conservative Republicans, which doesn't describe either of us, the most socially conservative Republicans still come to you with kindness and decency and
yeah,
compassion. They're real people. They're nice people. Republicans are really nice people. I like them.
You know? They don't shoot cops in the back of the head.
And they don't shoot cops in the back of the head.
For me, because I'm not on some cop butt-kissing contest, but I mean, it makes you like totally go to the side of the police.
I would enter such a competition.
Exactly. But I mean, we're sitting there, and there's people shooting police in the back, and Obama's like, well, they better reform. That's implying they deserve to die.
Mm-hmm.
That is so randomly killing people.
Yeah.
Anybody is just really gets to me.
Well, the left calls that victim blaming, don't they? You know, when a woman gets sexually assaulted for wearing a short skirt, you know, it's unacceptable to mention...
The mayor of Cologne.
Right.
It's said the women deserved it.
It's unacceptable to mention the fact that she was out late in a dark alley, drunk in a miniskirt, because, of course, you know, it's absolutely completely unacceptable to even suggest that she has any responsibility to keep herself safe.
Well, it's okay, because they're feminist
saying. Unless it's the Muslims, in which case... And he literally said women should go out with companions, maybe not stay out late. You know, I was half expecting him to say maybe they should wear hijabs. You know, like, I mean, seriously, this is the double standards is so insane.
Well, let's just say it. The West is where libertarianism, the Renaissance came from. We recognized our problems and made it more open.
What's the Enlightenment, right?
Exactly. But then we look at the fact that we're not perfect, and then we all get in this thing of hating ourselves when we are the best.
The West,
like
is,
Jim
the best.
Jim the West is the best. Jim Morrison, the West is the best.
West is the
and
best.
And so just stop saying the open, most free place in the world is the worst, because we're willing to look in the mirror with a bunch of people that chain women up like dogs. I mean, that is the biggest load of horse manure I've ever heard.
It's new, and I'm sorry to keep bringing it back to the gay thing, but, you know, it's like 100 million people live in Muslim countries where you can be swinging from a crane for having gay sex. And over here, I'm told that I'm the problem, that I'm hateful, and, you know, that I'm the, you know, that, and that Christians who don't want to bake a cake for a lesbian wedding are equivalent to Sally
Cohn. Yeah, let them have their free speech. Let them lose the business.
Sally Cohn. The dumbest woman in America. This, you know, the Jewish lesbian on CNN, Sally Cohn, awful, awful person, says that, you know, conservatives are just as bad as Muslims. You know, oh, please, please. The lack of perspective on the left is so astonishing to me.
Well, they're a cult. I know they're taking over. Let's take another call here. Let's talk to Ann in Indiana. Ann in Indiana, you're on the air. Go ahead with Milo.
Media people. I love you guys.
Hi.
We love you too, Ann. What's your point?
I'm a 60-year-old grandma. I love you both. Listen,
thank you.
I think Hillary is just the kind of woman that you're talking about, and mm-hmm. I'm very concerned that the Clinton crime machine is going to steal this election with voter fraud and take it over with Fox News and everything else. Mm-hmm. What can we do to combat this other than being...
Raise the alarm. They hope we all just don't notice it and go to sleep. Point out, this country is in a death battle. The greatest, like you said, everybody says it's every election. No, this, you can feel the energy, you can see mm-hmm. it. This is critical.
You can tell from what's going on in the streets. You can tell how excited people are on both sides. You've got Trump supporters who generally are well-mannered, fun, joyous, like the meme brigade. You know, you've probably been on the Donald, the Reddit, so, you know,
sure.
the subreddit. They're the most fun people on the internet. They're so great. You know, the fantastic, lively, good-natured discussions.
Smart.
Really smart, too. Like, really, really smart people. And then you've got, you know, the hateful, horrific, lesbianic, and Black Lives Matter mobs, you know. But both groups of people excited, really innovated about this election. I've never seen anything quite like that. I mean, I guess if you're worried about voter fraud, the answer is make sure Donald Trump gets a landslide so there's really nothing they can do, and it just reduces majority from, you know, 10% to 2 or whatever, but at least he wins.
That is the answer, man. Thank you so much. Any other points? She's gone. Like, I got a bunch of other callers, but the fourth hour is coming up. Who's hosting the fourth hour today? Talking to Houston.
Anthony
Gucciardi's hosting the fourth hour with a bunch of clips, well downs, the communists attacking, all the latest footage, everything else. Milo, I look forward to having you back on the broadcast with us.
I would love that.
And the callers, we're going to get to you after he's gone. But I appreciate you coming here and realizing this is a good place for open free speech live on the radio to almost 200 stations and, of course, on the internet. We got about 60 seconds. Any other points?
Thank you very much for having me. It's been a long time coming. I hope everybody enjoyed it. And I'd love to come back on again. It's very, very important, I think, to realize that America is at a crossroads in this election. I come to you as a warning from Europe. We have, you know, don't follow our future. Don't go in for Islamization.
And listen, regardless of whose speech it is, I agree with almost all your speech, but you're under attack, man. They're shutting you down. We're next. This is a major canary in the coal mine that got double X's in the eyes here. We've got to revive him over here. All right, we'll be back in 70 seconds with Anthony Gucciardi. Milo, thank you so much.
Thanks, buddy.
Great job. Great job, appreciate the crew, it. Too, and the rest of your crew.
The long sought after pieces exposing the true players behind the funding of the attack on the United States on September 11th, 2001 are finally, albeit slowly, being revealed. The Bush family caught in the crosshairs of public outcry, and now the evidence is stacking up. Paul Joseph Watson writes, Bush operative Ron Kaufman was seen pulling committee members from the meeting and begging members not to embarrass the president. The 28 pages were originally classified by the Bush administration in 2002 on national security grounds. But pressure had been building for the release ever since. And now, the heavily redacted version of the 28 pages have been released. Adan Salazar writes, "While in the United States, some of the September 11th hijackers were in contact with and received support or assistance from individuals who may be connected to the Saudi government. There is information, primarily from FBI sources, that at least two of those individuals were alleged by some to be Saudi intelligence officers. The intelligence community also has information, much of which has yet to be independently verified, indicating that individuals associated with the Saudi government in the United States may have other ties to Al-Qaeda and other terrorist groups. Joint inquiry officials also commented that the CIA and FBI's failure to address the Saudi issue was unacceptable. Previously, several law enforcement agents, including the FBI and police, came forward with statements that investigations were inhibited when it came to looking at Saudi Arabia's role. The FBI was thwarted from interviewing the Saudis we wanted to interview by the White House," said former FBI agent and investigator Mark Rossini, who added the White House let them off the hook. Questions still remain, given White House advisor Richard Clark's admitted involvement in removing Saudi officials from the country following the 9/11 attacks. The New York Times reported in 2003 that Clark had said he agreed to the extraordinary plan because the Federal Bureau of Investigation assured him that the departing Saudis were not linked to terrorism. And now those 28 pages have possibly led down a crooked path right to Hillary Clinton herself. The Nixon-esque, Saudi-backed Democratic candidate for president of the United States. Rough numbers show that Hillary's campaign has raked in funding anywhere from 20 to 40% from the Saudi government, spurred on by her close association with the mysterious Huma Abedin. Breitbart reported, "The World Assembly of Muslim Youth is specifically named as having connections to terror funding and support for a number of worldwide terror groups. The Abedin Family Business is an academic group called the Institute for Muslim Minority Affairs that is based in the London offices of the World Assembly of Muslim Youth and its parent organization, the Muslim World League." Page 24 of the 28 pages discusses Osama bin Laden's half-brother and says in part, "According to the FBI, Abdullah bin Laden has a number of connections to terrorist organizations. He is the president and director of the World Arab Muslim Youth Association and the Institute of Islamic and Arabic Science in America. Both organizations are local branches of non-governmental organizations, NGOs, based in Riyadh, Saudi Arabia. In 1998, the CIA published a paper characterizing WAMI as an NGO that provides funding, logistical support, and training with possible connections to the Arab Afghans Network, Hamas, Algerian extremists, and Philippine militants. Although the 28 pages make no mention of Abedin at all, the information in the 28 pages lays out a timeline of events during the planning and execution of the 9/11 terror attack that shows that, at all times, Huma Abedin was working for both Hillary Clinton and the WAMI organization, the Institute for Muslim Minority Affairs. The whole plan is now blindingly obvious. Essentially, Saudi Arabia funded the Bush administration's double cross of the American people on 9/11, whereby, as a result, the Eurasian strategy, as foreseen by Zbigniew Brzezinski, would have the American people's war machine stirring up the Middle East until the time came when that chaos would be exported to Europe and the United States, as is abundantly evident today.
Namely, in earlier times.
The fourth hour, it's the Alex Jones Show. I'm Anthony Gucciardi. And man, what a good interview with Milo. Alex and Milo going back and forth. And it's funny because political correctness, it claims, itself, the establishment that backs political correctness and the people that buy into it, it claims that, oh, it's going to help flourish and create safer ideas and concepts and create a safe space for us to discuss ideas. But in fact, it's the total opposite. It's word domination. It's idea domination. It's restriction of vocabulary. It's restriction of thought. It's restriction of growth in every single area because you're not allowed to go into certain areas. You're not allowed to talk about certain things, right? And what happens when you restrict things? Well, number one, you don't get to explore the fullness, the full spectrum of ideas and the world. You don't get to discuss certain things on air. Like, we're not allowed to talk about things on this program here that could offend people, right? And what's really funny is a lot of it that it attacks, I'm sure there is real racism, real discrimination, whatever, is such ridiculousness that you are then turning it into a form of political control. Clearly, a lot of you know this, but it's a political control that is deeply rooted. Now, the opposite of what they want to happen, though, is happening. And people aren't buying it. People are not buying any of it. And I think, you know, I was just talking before I got on the show, we are in the most organic time in human history in the spread of information and the spread of ideas, despite the attempts to quell every single angle of it. We are in the most ridiculous times, the most amazing times, the most best of times, worst of times. Look at someone like Milo getting banned from Twitter, whether you agree with him or not. And that's the details, right? We always lose because we don't know the details. Milo, even if you don't agree with him, well, gee, it's not good that he gets banned from Twitter because someone gets offended. That's probably not a good thing. But the fact that he gets banned then creates the so-called Barbara Streisand effect, where everyone actually cares, and then it turns into an insane viral thing throughout the internet on Twitter and social media and Facebook. Just like when the communists attacked Alex the other day. We're going to play some videos about that coming up on the show, too, about how the communists attacked Alex, some video angles in a Facebook report you haven't seen. And we're also going to play the communist lights self on fire while burning U.S. flag. Yes. But what happens when someone who's so upset that instead of discussing something, they have to go up and start trampling someone they disagree with, which is the communists attacking Alex? What happens? Did they get their point across? Did they really get a victory? No, they made Alex the number one trend on Twitter. They made him one of the top posts on social media, one of the biggest news stories. It's on the nightly news across the United States. They made it bigger. They made it bigger. So just like they try to force political correctness and word policing on our languages and our thoughts, it's going to blow back, and it already has. So now everything is way more organic. The news coming in, the mainstream media systems coming in and trying to silence things and turn into a race-baiting issue is not working anymore. It's just not working. People aren't having it. They're fighting back. And that is, as above, so below. We see it on a micro level with what just happened to Alex with the communists attacking him. That's a geopolitical phenomenon that's happening right now. It's not working. We're pushing back, and it actually is a form of victory. So whether or not the main thread of, you know, Donald Trump and everything you agree with, the point is, guess what? The narrative isn't controlled anymore. It's freaking them out, and we're pushing through the cracks like grass sprouting through the sidewalk. And it's pretty much the most organic time in history because we can instantly put out information. This is going out to millions of people over time through live stream and Facebook and every social media, YouTube, et cetera. Never before could we do that in just real time, just pumping out the information. And you are a part of all of it. You're the reason for all of it. Now, we're also going to take some calls. I think I'll take some in this segment as well. I wanted to just play this clip from Faraj, though, about the elite can't stop populism spreading on the internet. And it kind of shows what I'm talking about. He told this to Kit Daniels at InfoWars. Let's go ahead and play this clip real quick.
InfoWars.com. The global elite will try to gain more control of the internet to stop grassroots movements like UKIP.
Well, you know, clearly the Chinese would like to abolish the internet effectively. Do you know what? Government can try if it wants to. It will never keep up with the free market. It will never keep up with innovation. The internet, Brexit would not have happened without the internet. The internet is here to stay.
And so is the idea of free-flowing information, the idea of anti-establishment, so-called thoughts, which basically just means, by the way, and the elite and the establishment, spooky words, it just means not going with the system that's forced down your throat. It just means that, wow, yeah, people are upset because they bought into the lie. They were told that if they studied hard in school and did as they were told and got their degree and went into debt and worked at a job they hated for a corporation they don't believe in, that they'd somehow be happy. And if they turn on the nightly news and watched about how all the terrible crime in their neighborhood and nothing is going on and everything's fine, that they would somehow be fulfilled. Somehow that would give them happiness. But that's a bunch of BS. That's a bunch of BS, and people are mad about it. And some people choose to tune into programs like this. Some people choose to make videos. Some people choose to sit in this chair. Some people choose to write. Some people choose to do something about it, right? But some people choose to funnel their anger and their hatred and their the fact that they bought a lie and they're pissed off about it into things like saying we should kill the police or attacking the police. See, that's the difference. Funneling it into something that's actually valuable and meaningful, as opposed to going out and saying, let's kill cops. Just unfiltered rage. It's from the same point because everyone's all been screwed over. The country itself, I mean, 60%+ have less than $1,000 in their bank account. They're pissed off. They believe the lie as the so-called elite loot the country. The banking elite that did multiple collapses throughout modern history, they just keep coming in and looting it. And we have to pay the toll and we're pissed off. But the difference is what you actually do about it, because action is the only thing that actually matters. Now we're going to take some calls before we go into this next segment and play some of these special reports and talk about some news. U.S. Navy's newest $12.9 billion supercarrier doesn't work. And people wonder why we don't trust much of the system. Most expensive warship ever built, quote, struggles with jets taking off and landing, according to internal memo, as delivery is delayed again. Just like how they put those black plastic balls in the lake in California to stop the absorption of water, something like that. And it turns out it just grows mold or bacteria and they have to remove them all. It costs like $12 million. It's like, well, gee, wait a minute. The most ridiculous spending on stuff that never works. Maybe we shouldn't trust these people to make decisions about how to run our lives and what we can and can't say. Maybe they shouldn't regulate the internet. Maybe they shouldn't regulate social media. What a wild, wild thought, right? All right, let's go ahead and take Chris in North Carolina. Let's talk about PC culture. Chris, what you got?
Yes, sir.
What do you want to say, Chris?
I'm sorry. Fine. I was going to talk about how Poole's racist and the mood of like the last guest, and therefore, so you can't play it if you're white. So just one white ball knocking down a bunch of colored balls, and there's a white person's pocket. But I'll tell you what you do: you go out, get yourself a volleyball, and you get that big black burly bowling ball. You're knocking down a bunch of white pins, trying to get yourself knocked back. See what I'm saying?
So your point is that basically you can claim everything is racist and everything is not PC enough.
No, I'm kidding, actually.
I know you're joking around. I understand, Chris. All right. Well, thanks for that joke. Chris, thank you for your call. Let's go to Corey in Connecticut about social media on Twitter and protesting Twitter. What's up, Corey?
Hey, what's going on, Anthony? How are you?
I'm excellent.
I was going to hit this question up from Milo earlier because the amount of people now that are starting to realize what's going on in this country, the biggest unifying thing, obviously, is our Constitution. But as a form of protest for what Twitter did, I was going to give him the idea is to make an international day to where we have approximately a week now to the DNC, is to call it Fifth Amendment Day, to where we use silence as a weapon in a form of protecting our constitutional right to keeping ourselves quiet, but also an act of free speech to where not only all of the media outlets, but on top of that, all of the social media companies would get the hint of everybody at one time for one day on the day that the Democratic National Convention goes on is to not use social media whatsoever as a form of protest against these acts that they're committing against us right now. And I was going to run that by you guys and see if that would be a huge campaign. Imagine everybody right now creating that video, that Twitter hashtag, and throwing it up there and then not using social media, not allow the media to use it as a weapon against us, but us using our silence to get them to have the point across that the people in mass numbers can make a difference with even just their silence, let alone the way that they speak.
First of all, I like your idea of action, actually doing something, right? So people just sit around and complain they don't want to do anything. Here's my view on social media. I think social media is a beautiful tool. I think the fact that we have kind of been sucked into it with an idea of it being open, and then clearly it is not policed anywhere near open, and we've all been sucked into it, right? So we're already there, and Matt Drudge says it's the internet ghetto, right? So you're kind of forced into it. You're forced to live there. You're already on Facebook. You're already on Twitter. Your reach is already there. Now, at the same time, I think it is a tool. I think Facebook is an amazing thing in many ways. I think your smartphone is an amazing thing. It's opportunity. You can reach millions and millions more people on Facebook, on Twitter, et cetera, et cetera. Clearly, the issue is, okay, but now you're on there. Now you're locked in. You've got your platform on there. I mean, someone could not like what I say on Facebook that works for Facebook and shut everything down, right? So that is clearly the issue. But instead of kind of like going and saying, well, we're done. We're going to not dissing your idea, Corey, by the way, I like it. I'm saying, but in general, the people saying, well, we're just going to leave Facebook and make a new Facebook. We're going to leave Twitter and make a new Twitter, like an open-minded liberty thing. That's surrendering. That's giving up. There's already billion plus people on Facebook. There's already countless people on Twitter, on Snapchat, on everything. We can't just be like, oh, well, they censored us. We're going to leave now. We're never coming back. We have to fight for it. We have to say, hey, this is not cool. Censorship in any form. This isn't China. This is absurd. Instead of running away. All right, we'll be right back. More news, more calls, videos, communists attacking Alex Jones. We'll be right back. This is The Alex Jones Show. Talking about political correctness. Daily News, two arrested in Turkey for praising failed coup attempt on social media. So, two people have been arrested for praising the July 15 failed coup attempt on social media and insulting President Erdogan. Oh, my word. They insulted the president. The president, yeah, right. In the central Anatolian province of Karaman and the Black Sea province of Zonguldak. So, they got arrested for not even being a part of it, but praising it. And then you say, well, that's just the crazy, you know, thing going on in Turkey. Actually, I believe it was the Netherlands. I had it last week. We didn't get a chance to go over it. The king, someone insulted the president or the king or whatever, and he had them arrested on social media. He said something like, you know, some absurd thing like, you know, the king is a piece of crap or whatever. And they were like, oh, my word. And they reported it in their official news media outlet as if it was like the worst thing ever. Like, two were arrested for insulting him. So it's not that far gone, right? It's not like, oh, well, that's Turkey. No, it's happened in several countries where you would consider to be on a level of the United States. Maybe we can pull it up, actually, too, because I didn't get a chance to bring it in today. Now, what we're going to do is, coming up, I'm going to play The Truth About Milo from Paul Joseph Watson, since he was just on the show with Alex. It's a good video. And then 6.5 minutes of communist attacking Alex Jones. He's going to break it down in a Facebook video that we've not premiered yet. We're also going to show the communist lights self on fire while burning a U.S. flag. But first, before we get into that, we're going to take a few more calls talking about political correctness, talking about everything that's going on at the RNC. I also wanted to remind you, I had to ask them back there because the DNA 4 special should actually be down right now. But I guess they were able to hold a few bottles back. So go to InfoWarsLife.com right now if you want to get DNA 4 for 25% off. By the end of this show, we're actually going to have to take it down for sure. I didn't even know it was up. So definitely go to InfoWarsLife.com if it's your last chance to get DNA 4 for 25% off. The BioPQQ in DNA 4 is over the top, absurd. It's backed by 175 clinical studies. I could talk all day about it. It's the stuff. PQQ is what they find in Stardust. The patented ingredient, it's like $30,000 per batch when we buy it. It's absurd, and that's just one ingredient. You've got the CoQ10, which is a super long-lasting antioxidant. For me, DNA Force is just beyond Rolls Royce, beyond Lambo of antioxidant activity. And you can read about it on InfoWarsLife.com. Check out what it actually does. See if you want it. You're actually going to if you read it, in my view. It's the most advanced formula on InfoWars Life. Also, there's Oakley glasses and gear on InfoWarsStore.com. Alex just started carrying it. He's wearing them all the time. He's like, why not just have it in the store? So the guys at Oakley partnered up with Alex, and you've got the sunglasses, backpacks, what they call pilot gloves, which are just cool gloves, and all of that's for the best prices, InfoWarsStore.com. Just got some Oakley sunglasses myself. Look pretty good. So we're going to go ahead and blitz through one or two more calls before we go to break and play these special reports. Let's go ahead and talk to James in Washington. James, what do you got?
Hey, how you doing? Thanks for taking my call.
Thank you for calling.
Well, I just went on your YouTube video and a channel and saw one of your latest Ted Cruz, Ted Cruz a shill.
All right.
That was called. And I love you guys. Take this from love, but I'm seeing a pattern that we're focusing on the left wing, and we still got wolves in sheep's clothing on the right. And my point in bringing this up is some of the most important people we need to put in the spotlight to make sure the truth is no compromised is like Larry Pratt. And I've noticed he supported and endorsed Ted Cruz even in every newsletter that I get once a week. And I'm seeing a pattern with you guys not having somebody like Larry Pratt on your radio program during this whole presidential thing. And it kind of makes you guys look like you're still either ignorantly or knowingly supporting the right-wing neocons that are the ones we should be watching out for more than anybody, because Hillary's sheep's clothing has already been stripped. She don't deceive me. So we need to get Larry Pratt on your show and explain and go into detail why he still, and gun owners of America, the true constitutionalists of America, support people like Ted Cruz and stop beating around the bush. And like I said, I say this in love to you guys.
Hey, I think you made a lot of great points. In fact, I want to talk about it when we come back. We'll keep you online. And am I supporting neocons? I didn't know I was. I don't know who you're talking about. I don't know what you're talking about. All right, we'll be right back. Let's talk more about that. This is the Alex Jones Show. Stay tuned. That's the funny thing about complex issues, right? It's almost like people just want you to be on A or B. Life is a multiple choice question. Life is not a standardized test. You don't just get to pick A, B, C, or D, right? There's endless options. It's not a fill in the blank. And, you know, the last caller, so I wanted to talk to him. I'm going to pull him back here in a second on the air.
Actually, it looks like that last caller just dropped off.
All right, cool. Well, yeah, he hung up. But the point is, before the break, he called in and he was basically saying, number one, you guys, and I guess he's talking about InfoWars, you guys don't talk enough about the right, the neocons, the conservatives, Ted Cruz, et cetera. And he wanted to have Larry Pratt on the show. Now, I could be wrong. The producers can correct me if I'm wrong. I think Larry Pratt comes on the show all the time. I think he comes on like once a month. But that's not the issue. And the reason I want to talk about this call is, you know, I don't have to even address some of the callers that say absurd stuff, but this guy has a good point. I like his point. So number one, since day one, I came on the show with Alex and we talked about Ted Cruz, and Alex talks about Ted Cruz all the time. He is, in my view, one of the fakest politicians on the planet. He sounds completely like a plastic, just not real human being when he gets up there. So you can listen to how people speak, you know, how politicians speak, and even Mike, Trump's new VP, sounds to me, Mike Pence, sounds very fake. I do not like the way he speaks. I do not like a lot of his policies, like saying that he supports sending homosexuals to basically re-education camps and things like that. Okay, so I'm definitely not sitting up here saying I'm a Republican in any way, and neither is Alex. Okay, so when he goes to cover the RNC, it doesn't mean he is a Republican. Okay, when he goes to cover the DNC, it doesn't mean he's a Democrat. And when we talk about people specifically policy wise, and we talk about people, you know, about what they're doing, it doesn't mean we support them or against them. Sometimes it's just we're talking about their policy. Now, Ted Cruz to me sounds like he's just literally sitting up there, just can't even have a real word coming out of his mouth. Like, in a difference between, hey, what's up? How's it going? To hello, how are you all tonight? You know, just so fake and so absurd. Now, as in regards to attacking the left, okay, and I hate the left-right paradigm. I really do. I really, really think it should be completely destroyed. But of course, they're going to have a large percentage of the population that's only going to see left versus right. They're going to see Democrat, Republican. They're going to have to vote that way. They're not at the point yet, we're working on it, where we can go out and say, well, that's not even a real thing. Let's just vote between people we like. They don't have to pick a side, pick a party. But that said, yeah, the caller might know that Hillary Clinton has engaged in various criminal activities, but what percentage of the population is fully aware of what she's done, right? So just because you know something or because I know something doesn't mean everyone does also. So I think you're totally right. We shouldn't pick sides, and I don't think we have. I definitely have not. And instead, you need to look at the details of people and look at the actual reality as opposed to picking labels, picking sides, left versus right. You attack the left, you don't attack the right. It's just all a game. It's all insane. Just like political correctness, it's intellectual verbal domination to make you choose something so you can label yourself. Like if you go to a party and they ask, what's your political affiliation? I do not have it. I do not have one. I have the third party of reality. I'm on the third party of reality. If I like something about someone, Or maybe there's some bad stuff about them because no one's perfect. Well, I can maybe see past that if they're for, you know, something overarching that's good. But I'm not going to say I'm a Democrat, I'm a Republican. That's an easy way to have someone shut down your entire viewpoint and your entire speech in their mind because they already have preconceived notions. Now, what I want to do is I want to go ahead and start talking about the communists attacking Alex. Number one, because I think it is totally insane. Number two, I think it's something that is worth viewing. And number three, I think it illustrates the insanity that we have reached in this country in many ways. So you have actual people in the Communist Party. What happened is Alex is out filming at the RNC, and they could not help themselves. Instead of, as I was saying earlier, maybe debating, instead of writing an article, instead of doing a video or whatever, they just had to start trampling him. They had to attack him because they just didn't know what else to do. And Alex shot this video. It was up on Facebook. I wanted to play it. He mentioned it earlier. It's about the communist attack. He breaks it down, some of the footage that's not been aired before. So let's go ahead and play this video from Alex about the communists attacking him.
We're on Facebook mentions, we're on YouTube, we're on Periscope. We just went a few blocks away from what happened a few minutes ago. Mr. Dix, the founder of one of the major communist organizations in the country, was having a Black Lives Matter event here in Cleveland, just a block away from the RNC. I mean, the communists have killed hundreds of millions of people. They're worse than Hitler. And they've been trying to foment a revolution in this country. And Obama and George Soros, who's a Romanian communist, Soros, have been trying to foment this whole thing that if a cop kills somebody questionably in Minnesota, you go kill five cops in Dallas. It's just the most crazy crap I've ever heard, or just randomly shoot people. So I've been against that. And I thought, well, let's go out and try to cover this. And so we went there, we were speaking. There were state police, local police there, you name it. And we were going to go up on top of some of the steps to speak. So we start going up there peacefully. And some communists with red flags were saying Hitler, racist, Nazi. It's all on video. The video's going up on Infowars.com. Start hitting me. And so I just decided to go ahead and push the guy out of my way. And so suddenly I pushed through them. And then I didn't know it was the chief of police of Cleveland. You can't make this up. It's right there. He grabs my arm, but he wasn't hitting me. So I stopped. And then another off-duty police officer who we actually have right here actually talked to him, so I didn't get arrested. Then all the state police came and grabbed me because I didn't realize they were punching the police. We have all this video attacking them. So the police, like Roman techniques, had their bikes like blocking six attackers at a time. We have all this epic footage. It's just crazy how this country's at war. But if you want to blame the federal government or even the state government, blame the governor, blame the president, like some average cop. You're going to blame them like they're out to get you? That's the craziest crap I ever saw. So I literally thought we'd just go cover this communist Black Lives Matter meeting. What's his name? Carl? Charles Dix and all these other guys. Cornel West, the big socialist. I thought we would just go cover this and that literally it would be okay. But now I realize it is so charged. Dead cops in Baton Rouge, dead cops in Dallas, dead cops in Philadelphia, dead cops amazing. Every city, Islamic attacks. I've seen Islamists out here. I mean, these people really think this is their time to overthrow America because Obama is encouraging it. If you overthrow any cities, it'll just make the stock market plunge. You'll be out of jobs. It's like it is the takedown of this country. But all I want to get out there is the leftists are putting out tweets that I attacked the police. They would have arrested me if I did that. They realized I was pushing through some people attacking me. The police chief grabbed my arm. What's the luck? Other police explain what happened. They protected me, ran me out of the area. I didn't realize because you're only seeing what you're seeing. The police are being attacked. While they're getting me out of there, they're being punched and things are being thrown at them. Urine. There's supposedly video already out. They're throwing buckets of piss on the police.
And feces,
excuse me. You can't make, who does this? So Kevin is an off-duty police officer. He was there. He actually protected us. And later we talked to him. So he's here with us a few blocks from where this happened. Kevin, we haven't scripted what we're talking about here. That's my perspective on what happened. But I was only seeing what I saw. What did you see? Come on in, guys. Talk to him.
Well, after you were talking, there was two gentlemen of the Communist Party that came in
and basically attacked Alex. Alex had to push them back. He lost his balance. Went into the police chief, and I secured the individuals that were attacking Alex. The one kid was coming actually over my head to try and punch Alex. So we had, at that point, it was a real safety issue, and we had to scoot out of there real fast because it was getting extremely volatile and dangerous. So,
what is it like for you to see this? I mean, I've never seen anything like this. I didn't expect this.
Well, I mean, it's sad. It's very sad to watch, you know, the fabric of our values and our Constitution. And, you know, these kids that have the free speech, it's there because we're Americans.
People pay for it.
Exactly. And, you know, when you're hearing kids saying, you know, we hate the country, they're stepping on our flag, you know, as a true American and a patriot, it hurts your heart to watch that. And
I forgot, they were also burning American flags today.
Yeah. So,
thank you for protecting me. I had no idea how dangerous it was. And
yeah,
I appreciate you being there and the other. I was really surprised how fast the state police got me out of there.
Yeah. Well, you know, you have a right to protect yourself, and all you did was push the kid, and, you know, to save yourself. And so there was no attack on your part at all. It was.
Well, what do you expect the next 3 days of this as this unfolds? This is getting crazy.
This is going to just open up from here, I believe.
Well, I couldn't imagine being a police officer randomly out there with a family to go back to, and there's groups openly calling for you to be shot, like the new Black Panther Party and others. I got to ask questions. We have videos of them calling for cops to be killed. If I called for that, that's organizing crime. I should be arrested. I don't understand why they're allowed to do it. Why are they allowed to do it?
Well, it's I guess part of free speech, but. I guess it's protected.
I don't think it's protected when you organize something, though. When I say rob a bank, that's not free speech.
No.
Well, it's coming to an end, folks. They want to destroy our free speech. They want to use it to destroy our country. We're not putting up with it. Trump's not perfect. I'm not perfect. But the point is, he's not Hillary. We are moving forward to secure this republic. That's why the enemies of this country are making their move, because they know we've woken up. And InfoWars.com's covering it all. We're not going to be intimidated. We're going to be here the next 3 days covering it all. And we just hope that more Black Lives Matter connected groups don't spray police with bullets or innocent citizens. But just thank God we've got a Second Amendment to defend ourselves. But I got to tell you, honestly, I didn't expect the commies to attack me that fast. They immediately ran up, hit me with red flags, were punching me. I just pushed them out of my way. And luckily, the police drug me out. I didn't know they were attacking police en masse. It's all over the news. So that raw footage is getting uploaded right now. More raw footage coming out as we speak, but I wanted to put this statement out first and just thank God and for my family and my kids that everything went okay. And thanks to good folks like Kevin that protected us. We'll be talking to you soon. Thank you.
Thanks.
There's that video Alex shot live on Facebook, mentions on YouTube, on Periscope, which is Twitter. I'm glad Alex is all right. And it's really, really, it's sad, because the funny thing is, the people that are wanting more establishment in their lives, the people that are supporting the Communist Party, the people that are supporting more governments. And I don't mean just more government to build parks and fix roads and things. I mean more of the same people that continue to loot the system, that continue to screw us, people that want to usher that in, like the people that are burning U.S. flags and setting themselves on fire, which we're going to play here in a minute. Those people are actually just inviting the same demon into their lives that put them there in the first place. So why are they mad? They're mad because they don't have money. They're mad because they can't get a job. Maybe they're just mad because they have no skills and they're mentally ill. That's part of it too. But a lot of people are actually mad for real reasons. They're mad because they were screwed over. They're mad because they don't have the cash. They're mad because the system failed them. Now, why did the system fail them? Because the system is run by a bunch of corrupt criminals in many ways. Doesn't mean all government's bad, clearly. No, not at all. There's a lot of good people in government. There's a lot of good leaders out there. But the leadership generally in the United States is terrible. And what happens is, well, gee, they screwed us over. We're unhappy. What are we going to do? We need them to control more of our lives. That's what we need. Let's protest. We need them to control more of our lives. That makes perfect sense. It's like if you're in a relationship and the person is hitting you over and over again, and you're like bleeding and stuff, and you go to the hospital and they're like, wow, you know, you need to get out of that relationship. It's like, I know what I need to do. I need to move in with that person. No, that's not going to fix your problems. That's not working. That's absurd. That's the definition of insane. It's the definition of insane. doing the same thing over and over again, except it's more than insane. It's mega insane because you're not, I mean, just doing it over and over again, which would just be letting things happen. It's doing it more. So it's like 10x insane. It's like doing it even more than what's insane. Now, I do want to get some thoughts on this because I see Robert in New York wants to talk about Milo, Alex, and some of this communist stuff. And then we're going to play another video and hit some news. Robert, what do you think about communists attacking Alex? What do you think about what him and Milo were talking about? What's going on in your view?
Well, I'm from lower Manhattan, downtown Manhattan, New York. First of all, the Milo thing is it's retarded. I think it's the kid game. They're censoring real, you know, real stuff, and they're not letting other people have their words and say. Black Lives Matter is just inconsistent with everything it stands for. But what I'm really calling for is to thank you guys, first of all, and every Info Warrior, because I'm new to this whole thing. But I think what they did to Alex, what they're doing is wrong, and they do know it. It's just I live in between two projects, New York City Housing Authority projects. I do have a few people that have woken up. We all live in this hellhole, and I think we all have lived together long enough. So my question is more of, throughout all of what you guys are doing and what I'm doing, what on top of that can I do to wake these people up? We've been living like this for so long, and now it's a problem?
You know what's so amazing to me is that throughout my life, so first of all, I lived in Philadelphia most of my life. Okay, I've seen actual really, really bad stuff. And I grew up, I didn't grow up with tons of money, okay? I grew up to the point where going to get a sandwich at the deli or whatever would be a big deal, okay? I've been told before, hey, you need to cut back on your sandwiches, basically, okay? It's hurting the budget. To me, you know, going out to a really, really crappy restaurant was a big deal. Some of the most amazing people I've met in my whole life are the poorest people, the people that could go out and say they're a communist or say they want to, you know, kill cops or whatever because their lives are bad. Okay. They don't have the money. They've been screwed over. They've even had cops, you know, do bad things to them, but they choose instead of putting all of that into everyone's bad, all white people are bad, all black people are bad, whatever. They actually choose to do something with their life. And instead of using their past as an excuse, they use a lesson and go forward. And, you know, Robert, you say you live in the projects and you're with people in the projects. Do you see the consensus of all the actually good people wanting to do something about it, wanting to change the country, or are they all just blaming everyone else for their problems? What do you see?
Well, I do see it's a lot of blaming each other, but I also see it's like everybody wants to blame everybody else because they know they're not going to feel the downfall because they've never felt the downfall. And that's not just the black community. I'm talking about this whole community where I live.
No, I'm not talking about just the black community either. I'm talking about the community as a whole, the people that are down on their luck, but I see a lot of them are not just sitting there saying absurd things. I mean, most people, okay, it's actually only the extreme people. Even most people in Black Lives Matter, all right, they're not bad. They're not saying to kill cops, okay? And Black Lives do matter. All lives matter, all right? It's the extreme crazy people in the groups, which unfortunately, though, it seems is spreading. The insanity is spreading. Robert, I want to keep talking to you, but we got to skip the break, so we'll be back. We'll hold you over. Stay in line. This is the Alex Jones Show. Stay tuned. In a second here, I'm going to show you the video of communists light itself on fire while trying to burn a U.S. flag. But first of all, we're going to go back to this call here, too, in a second. Just want to remind you again, DNA Force is 25% off at InfoWarsLife.com. It is not going to be here in a few moments because it should have actually been taken down because we are pretty much out of stock. But if you want to get it, 25% off. It's your last, absolute last chance to get it. InfoWarsLife.com, DNA Force, 25% off. And check out the other products. They're the real deal. They work. Let me tell you, right to my left is about 20 of them, and they are used every single day. I take all of them pretty much every day on my protein shake. Now, Robert, I wanted to let you finish your point. You said you live in the Manhattan Projects, and you were talking about the atmosphere. And I was saying that some of the most inspirational people I ever met and some of the smartest people were down on their luck, except they didn't take that and then say, oh, I want to go kill cops, you know, everyone's bad, everyone's racist or whatever. They actually made something of themselves and were inspirational to me, which made me want to go and be better. I mean, they're a better person than I am. So it's a matter of choice. What do you think, Robert?
I do agree. And a lot of people, like you said, are wonderful people, and they do what they do need to do. But and first of all, let me thank you for being the most genuine media around, and that's just being honest. But my question is, how would I reach the most radicalized people out of, I don't want to word it in the wrong way because I am not racist. I love all mankind. But the people that are ignorant of the fact that if they keep doing this, we will really have some really bad problems. But the best ideas do come from places like this because everybody's trying to get out. But there are a lot of people that are still stuck in the same position, and they still want things from the government. So my question would be, how do I change that? How do I personally change that? Excuse me.
No worries. Thank you. And Robert, thank you for your call. I appreciate you, actually. You sound like a really genuine person yourself. Look, there's no one solution to just wake everyone up and change everything, right? But I think the ultimate solution that we should all be working towards is to remember that we're not battling each other, right? So someone to my right, someone to my left, they don't agree with me. They're on opposite sides. The dyad has shifted, okay? They vehemently disagree with all my positions. Well, guess what? We're still two human beings that have greater issues. That's why historically in times of war, not saying this is a good thing, people come together, right? Because they have a greater issue. What's happened now in society is that we've been pegged against each other. The media just loves a little fight, right? Loves infighting, loves to pit people against each other, make everything hot and cold. The truth is we have to remember that we're on the same side. We're on the same side. Some idiot just took a stick in the sand and put a line down the middle, and now we're all afraid to cross it. We're all afraid, and we're like, oh, we're divided. It's fake division. It's fake. It's all BS. And none of it is real. We have to remember we're all human beings facing the same greater issues. Greater issues than someone getting triggered by a politically incorrect word that doesn't matter. Greater issues than someone freaking out because something that they saw online was racist or arguing on Facebook, okay? These are all just little minute problems. We need to remember the greater issues. We are all needing to come together. It is through the artificial division that we are failing and we are losing the battle 100%. So instead of in viewing it as that person is wrong and I need to tell them what is right, not saying you do that to call her, by the way, just in general, we need to remember to bring them on the same side, man. Wake them up and remember, smack them in the face, say, hey, there's bigger stuff going on. We're all being screwed. The establishment system is screwing all of us. It's not just, you know, the little tiny things the media makes us care about because they don't control the narrative anymore. So we got to bring back the narrative and hijack it. We're all on the same team. We're on a lifeboat. It's got holes in it. Everyone's punching each other in the head. It's not going to work. All right. Alex will be back tomorrow from 11 a.m. to 2 p.m. Central covering the RNC. Tomorrow's Friday. It's going to be a big last day. Don't miss it. Alex Jones Show. I'm Anthony Gucciardi signing off. Thank you very much.